feature presentation.
Wibbly wobbly timey wimey, everybody. This is the Untitled Movie Show for Wednesday, October 21st, 2015, on Back to the Future Day. That's why I started with the time reference. But that's not the only reason, and we'll get to that in a minute. But first, let's talk to the Marty McFly of the Retro Unlimited Network, Lawn Boys Post, Mr. Dave Wade.
Alonzi. See what I did there?
Ah, you crossed the streams there. That's a bad idea. Remember that. And we've also got on the ones and twos the Emmett Brown of the Retro and Limb Network, Mr. Nick Horacek, doing us a solid at the last minute. We do appreciate that.
Great Scott. Yeah, I'm here. Everyone's scrambling the last freaking minute, and I'm usually not doing anything on nights after work, so here I am. Well,
we do appreciate it, and this, like I said before, this might be one of the last times that you do us this favor, but we'll get to that at the end of the show. And,
but you are always welcome, sir. You are always welcome.
Oh, most definitely. And we do have a special guest, but he had to go out to throw up, the Biff Tannen of the Retro Wadlim Network, Mr. Michael Burhan. Oh, he's here. Oh, Burhan.
Hi. Sorry, guys. I've got a bit of the flu, and I'm still trying to recover from it, so I've got a lot of mucus coming out. I'm fine. I've just, like, gone. I just quickly went out to the woods, and it was dark.
Oh, you poor thing. Did you have to collect several bits of paper with a flashlight?
Did you see any bear shit?
No. I did, like, yesterday, actually. I was saying to a friend of mine, I heard cats, like, fucking outside.
Oh, you cats are fucking noisy, mate. Sorry.
I know, they are. I was, like, lying in bed, all here. And I'm like, okay, just going to sit here and just shut the fuck up and try and sleep.
You know, given your outdoorsy nature, I'm surprised you haven't collected, like, some type of, like, pet. Like, you see in those movies with, like, you know, drifters
squirrel.
And whatnot. Yeah. Some type of
That's my girlfriend. She does that. She's the one who collects pets. She's warning me that she's gonna one day come home.
Oh, I think we share an apartment. Squirrel and call it Conker.
No, I'm not the crazy, like, woodsy good dude yet. You know, I've managed to kind of avoid all that. But you know, I've been kind of in the woods for. I've kind of been very outdoorsy for like 6 months now, nearly. So it's getting better. Things are working out and things are moving forward, and that's kind of the good thing about it. And it's nice to be back, even for kind of the final time on the Untitled Movie Show.
Not
for
the
now.
Final time, the final time as we are known right now. We're like a caterpillar waiting to metamorphose.
Well, I was going to wait until the end of the show to mention that, but I figure we might as well start with that. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, I pissed on your chips.
Oh, no. I just didn't want to start off on a low note, but yeah. This is actually going to be the last episode of the Untitled Movie Show. Now, Burhan said for now, and that's a bit, it's not a wrong statement, but we are working towards bringing up a new, you know, we're working towards something in the future. I don't want to say too much because I don't want to bring up anybody's hopes, but as far as this show in its incarnation, this will be the last episode. Will it come back? More than likely. Will it come back in this form as this show? Probably not. I may end up making a new show altogether, depending on what topic I want to do. But
as long as with being Back to Future Day, when it comes back, can we all at the start just say, "Are we back? We're back." Sorry.
Well, it's funny. Somebody actually brought up a good point. I was reading a comic on that where it's like Marty McFly and Doc Brown coming to 2015, and they pass by people talking about RoboCop and Ninja Turtles and the Mad Max sequel, and then Marty just turns to Doc Brown and is like, you sure we went forward in time?
Yeah, but you know what would basically be more hilarious is that the fact that they come here and Marty goes, "Hey, we're here," and it's shit. Because... Nothing's changed.
Holy fuck, this isn't Blade Runner.
It's more like
somebody shows him Tumblr and he runs back to the car screaming, "Get in the car, Doc."
It's more like the fucking dystopian 1985 than...
Yeah, Donald Trump running for president. He's like, "Doc, get in the car! Get in the car!"
Do you know what it could be now, though, couldn't it? If they got stranded, in our 2015, it's like, okay, Doc, we need to find some other source to run the DeLorean, and I've had this crazy idea, call me stupid, but have you heard of something called Indiegogo?
Flux capacitors on Kickstarter. I wouldn't put it past College Humor or Funny or Die to do some type of Back to the Future Day thing where they poke fun of 2015 now. I'm sure they've got if they haven't already recorded it, it's going to be coming up within the week. So keep your eyes on that, guys. But yeah, so this is going to be
damn it, Pepsi charging $20 a bottle and only making 1,500 of them because I really wanted a future Pepsi. Sorry.
Oh, did you see the self lacing shoes that Michael J. Fox got? Nike actually made a custom pair.
I do like the fact that Nike is basically donating proceeds to the sale from each of these limited edition shoes to the Michael J. Fox Foundation.
They did this before, didn't they? About 2 years ago, where they made a really, really limited edition run of Air McFlys and sold them, auctioned them off to charity, and basically all of them went to famous people, which is good because they paid stupid money for them in the auction, which went to his foundation. But yeah, no, that's not a new thing. They've done it before, which
is
cool.
These actually do self-lace. The Air McFlys from before were just regular shoes. These actually, I think what I saw in the video is they have like a motor in them that if you put weight on the heel, will actually turn a motor within the shoe that will tighten up the laces for you. So,
does that mean if you're really, really, really overweight, you just walk around with really tight shoes on all the time?
I think they have an internal quick release.
They have a setting.
Dave, you can finally say it. It's a really big shoe.
It's a really big shoe.
Yes.
I think didn't they say that if it catches on that they might release more or some sorts? I mean,
these do, because before Nike made this limited run, there was one company in Hollywoodland that was a special effects company that had the right to make them, and they released like something like literally 150 pairs a year. And I think they were like $5,000 a pair.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are very expensive to make.
Yeah, but you know what? That I'm sure they'll find some type of cheaper alternative. Maybe not so much a motor, or they'll figure something out. But
they really missed the thing with the Back to the Future anniversary. They should have got Elijah Wood back and had him play a video, of having played Duck Hunt as an adult, but wearing the clothes he did in the Back to the Future.
Oh yeah, he was in the second movie. It's been so long since I've seen the second one. I mean, I've seen the first one countless times, but 2 and 3 are just, I haven't gone back to see them as much as I should. But I think, you know, they're classics. We did a whole episode last year about Back to the Future. We don't have to rehash that.
That was my last
Here's
birthday
the thing.
Episode.
Yeah, I went back. I actually watched the entire trilogy over the last couple of days. So
it's a good trilogy. You know, Robert Zemeckis made an amazing film, and you know, hopefully,
and just how things tie in from each movie. Love that. How it's.
It's one of the few true trilogies where the entire story is connected in one long story arc. Most movies nowadays that claim to be a trilogy are just three sequels.
Or like the Fast and the Furious franchise where they just fucking just do whatever the fuck they want.
Mm. Speaking of Fast and the Furious, to kind of tie this in, did you guys see the video that Vin Diesel put out of him playing Dungeons & Dragons in honor of his movie coming out, The Last Witch Hunter?
I did.
I saw the trailer for that yesterday. I was quite psyched.
You know, it I've said it before and I'll say it again. You take the muscles off of Vin Diesel, he's one of us. Like, he's just a regular
he's a massive D&D fan.
Yeah, like he is. Well, he's a D&D fan. He owns his own video game company. He's a geek just like any one of us. He just happens to be, you know, built Diesel, you know, like he's
yeah.
Does it have to be though? That the thing is, what bugs me about it is, does it have to be, like, can't nerds be muscular? It's like, you know, everyone has this whole stereotypical view of nerds having to be just basically these little weedy introvert types. And I think that's ridiculous. You know, every person, every culture, everything comes in all shapes and sizes. And I think we need to kind of remember that.
I get that, but he's one of the few ones in Hollywood that are open about it. Like, I'm sure there are geeks out there, but for the longest time, it was kind of just, it wasn't in vogue. Not until, you know, geek chic became something in the late 2000s. You know,
it's become more, it's becoming more and more of Hollywood culture now because everyone's a geek, you know. You know, going on from that, I do want to say bring up one little bit of news, and I just wanted to basically kind of die on my heel for this, because a lot of people, okay, Hollywood, right? Now this is the thing, and this is for those
Hollywood
people. Want to give you a little lesson in terms of how acting and freelancing and stuff works, right? actors have an agent. An agent helps you negotiate your contracts and fees. That's why they get their 20% from whatever you can make, or even
right,
more.
Right, this is
depending.
Going.
Jennifer Lawrence, basically, who's like the second highest paid actor of 2015, right? And I use the term actor because I don't like to be defined as actresses anymore. So actor. In 2015, she's right underneath Robert Downey Jr. She spent time bullshitting and writing an essay basically sounding like a butthurt teenager who was not hugged enough by daddy, basically stating that she's not getting paid enough in comparison to RDJ because she's a woman. And she brought gender bias into whole Hollywood. And there's so many people agreeing with her. And this is the thing. This is what really gets my, kind of grinds my gears and gets my head going a little bit. People can't fucking comment unless they understand how the system works in Hollywood. This isn't working for McDonald's. This isn't working for a retail company or working for a company that has a set wage system.
I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but it's basically bankability, isn't it?
Not just that. It's basically about how much your agent can negotiate. Like, for instance, I went to my old agent, booked me on a commercial. I did a commercial, right? And they penciled me in. The agent negotiated my fee. She failed to negotiate my fee to the point where she got a little bit greedy. And then I got written out and someone else, much cheaper, got written in. That's how it works. Mm-hmm. Now, her agent had to agree to a kind of a fee in order for her to obtain the role. The studio can sit there and go, nope, we're not doing that. And it's nothing about gender bias, you know. There's no point trying to say it's gender bias or it's due to race or it's due to fucking the fact that you're a transsexual or anything like that. It's not to do with anybody else, mm-hmm. right? It's not to do with anything about you. It's just to do with how well you can negotiate. Now, I also want to put into the fact here that Robert Downey Jr. has been doing this for years. I don't care how many fucking drug busts the guys have had. The man has been acting since the fucking, like, early 80s.
Yeah,
right?
I mean, he was doing work in SNL before he did movies, I think. No,
that was after he did movies, actually.
Oh, really? I thought it was before.
He was starting off as a film career, and then eventually he got booked in at SNL under actually a very high contract in order to boost the show's languishing ratings. Mm-hmm. And then that didn't work out, and I believe he only lasted one season, wasn't it?
Yeah, that whole
that was Steve Martin's job. I thought every time their ratings failed, they got Steve Martin on.
No. What happened?
People actually think he's a regular from the number
what
of times
was,
he showed up, but he's not.
Yeah, what happened was that was the season that Lorne Michaels came back because the ratings were tanking, so they brought Lorne Michaels back to it,
yeah.
And he decided to completely revamp the cast. This was the same season that Anthony Michael Hall was also a cast member, and they lasted one season because of a certain incident that happened where one of the actors that they had, I think it was Charles Rocket, that's who it was, yeah. Dropped the F-bomb on live television. Oof. And so NBC completely wiped the whole cast clean. They fired the entire cast. They fired Lorne Michaels, and that's basically why RDJ didn't last on that season because of that one incident. I've tried finding footage of that specific skit, but if you look online, the whole story's on there about that whole incident.
Yeah, and this is the thing as well, what people don't understand when it comes to stuff like that. Robert Downey Jr. has done a very long and very qualified career to the point where this guy is probably one of the most diverse and most entertaining actors on the planet. And the reason why he gets so much from Disney is because of the fact that he reinvented a B character. For those who don't know, Iron Man was he languished, you know, he wasn't a very fully understood character. He was very one-dimensional. You had some great stories that were behind him, but he was always considered the kind of billionaire philanthropist kind of like guy.
He's taken him back to that edgy level when he was more fleshed out in his 70s. It was groundbreaking when he was an alcoholic. He's not quite there in the movies, but he took him back to that vulnerability stage.
He was much basically built around as being a conservative type, you know, an American conservative who loves guns, loves women, fucking likes to sodomize everything, and wants to be a hero for the fucking point of it. What Robert Downey Jr. did, he gave this character more dimensions. He made this character. And you have to give props to John Favreau as well for, you know, penciling this thing and helping it come to realization. But the majority of it was RDJ, and he made this B-class character into a AAA character, right? To the point where he had a movie as Iron Man. And this is the thing. And even though I hate Iron Man 3, he made $1 billion off of this damn movie. The film grossed over $1 billion itself. And that shows you how much power he has behind him. So then Jennifer Lawrence sits there and bitches and moans, and people sitting there going, it's revolutionary. Fuck off.
Everyone saw my tits on the cloud because it got leaked. Well, that's what you get for taking a selfie with your tits hanging out.
Well, yeah.
When it comes to movements and it comes to right-wing feminism and all this and that bullshit, right, and someone's trying to sit there, and because I was having this conversation with someone recently about, like, the fact that there's big things out there that still need attention, you know, in terms of equality, like fathers who are not basically seeing their kids because of bullshit laws and stuff. And this person basically said to me about the whole feminism thing. She goes, well, feminists don't want to define themselves as mothers. So it was literally just saying, well, men can have the casts off. So we are fighting for you by de facto. Do you know what I mean? And it came out to that whole thing. And the thing that kind of really pisses me off about this is, out of all the places you can sit there and you can moan and complain about, Hollywood isn't that place, you know, and no one even complains about the porn industry where the women bank more than the men, to the point where straight men are doing gay porn just so they can earn more money. Imagine this. Do you remember someone's like saying, hey, I want to, you know, I'm not gay, but $20 is $20. These guys actually put that term into practice.
Yeah.
You know, they go gay just for the point of making money, and no one's complaining about that. But yet you want to complain about a man who has rightfully stood, and I believe he's been number one for the last, what, 3 years in terms of pay in Hollywood. And he basically deserves that. No one deserves it. I will fight you to the death, right, to tell me that Robert Downey Jr. does not deserve every penny that he has. And he even said it himself. He did it. It was on a whim. He said, right, I'm going to be leaving. And this is before Iron Man 3. I'm going to be leaving. And I'm going to basically give them a number. He knew he wasn't going to get this from Disney. But Disney went, all right.
Yeah, what? And then he basically turned it around on them. It's like, I was just going to... Yeah, and because he fought to have every other cast member of the Avengers get the same pay that he does.
Yeah.
So it wasn't that he was just, you know, asking for money and Disney was just obliging. He was calling Disney's bluff, and Disney basically called his. And there was this whole argument about it. He wasn't going to come back for three if they didn't get, you know, equal pay, which I believe they did, if I'm not mistaken, because he did end up coming back, obviously.
Everybody got the pay that they were worth for their characters and stuff. And this is the thing, and this is why everybody at the moment, like Chris Hemsworth, Chris Evans, everybody on the team are basically saying we may not come back again to these roles after the Infinity War, because there's so much done with it, and there's not really how far they can go. It'll become a paycheck role eventually.
Yeah, keep in mind that a lot of them are doing this because they want to be known for more than just that. I mean, Chris Evans has been trying to do stuff like Snowpiercer and what was the other one? I think it was The Frozen Ground, the John Cusack, Nick Cage movie. I think he was in that. He's been trying to do like avant-garde movies to try to broaden his horizon for years, and they have not made any money, and he does not want to be stuck.
RDJ movie that basically bombed, even though it was a fucking terrific movie, The Judge.
Mm-hmm.
I watched that the other day. I was like sitting there going, my God, why didn't this movie make any more? And the problem is, we're now trained to believe that, you know, these Marvel movies are where this needs to go. And that's kind of the shame behind it. Do you know what I mean? It is a shame. And I think, but in terms of people like Jennifer Lawrence's, one, pay your fucking dues, because she hasn't paid her dues.
Yeah.
Right. She's done a couple of roles. She got big from playing Mystique. She got big from playing the Hunger Games movies. But it's going to be after these movies.
Yeah, she was Katniss Everdeen in those movies. But yeah, that's what like people got attention for, you know, her, because Hunger Games.
Yeah,
so.
And I'm sorry. Here's the thing I also want to bring up. It's a different kind of Hollywood now. And we've talked about this when we talked about action movies. The days of celebrities being able to sell themselves on names is dying out. And it's becoming less about, who you are, more so what can you play? What can you attach yourself to? That's why Jennifer Lawrence leapt to the role of Mystique. That's why she leapt to the role of Katniss Everdeen, because, you know, she's smart and understands that you have to attach yourself to a character if you want to have a bankable, a bankable celebrity status. So it's a different kind of Hollywood. But I do agree that it's ridiculous that somebody
who has the best job in Hollywood, by the way?
Who?
The person who has to do the makeup for Mystique.
both of them, both during Lawrence days and the Rebecca Romijn days.
The thing that really bugs me about this is you have to understand where she's basically, I think she was only a small amount behind the dude. She earned like 65 mil and he earned like 80 mil or something like that. And the fact that she calls him out makes me laugh, because I sit there and think to myself, your career is very fresh, your career is very early. Don't start bringing bullshit into it, because eventually you're going to basically be looking at these days, the days where you were cast in these mainstream roles, to the point where you're not going to basically be sitting there thinking to yourself, shit, where did it all go? And it's all gone down at a drop of a hat. And I'm not sitting here going, oh, your career's going to die. But it's about how much credibility you have after the fact, you know? And yeah, I understand, oh, I've done two movies and I'm only grossing just under what RDJ's grossing, and women aren't being treated well in Hollywood. No one's being treated well in Hollywood. Do people understand that Hollywood isn't the same place that it used to? Well, it kind of is the same place, to the fact that you get chewed up and spat out in Hollywood.
Yeah. And
you gotta take what you can get. You know?
Yeah, and this whole push, I think, is it's a bit iffy. Between this and Emma Watson's speech that she gave to the UN, which was kind of the same thing, except she didn't call out Robert Downey Jr. I mean, it's
the
not.
The thing is, Emma Watson was talking about real issues. She was talking about like vaginal mutilation, which is a real issue. She was talking about sex trade, which is a real issue.
Yeah,
how much women get paid in Hollywood isn't an issue. Talking about the fact that, by the way, a female exec, you know, called Angelina Jolie difficult to work with, right? Yeah, I love the fact you left the gender out there, Jen, just so you know, right? Said basically that Angelina Jolie was difficult to work with in a Sony email. And by the way, she and Brad Pitt have admitted this as well, that she became very difficult to work with at the time when she was feeling depressed. And the fact that she was actually suffering, she thought she had cancer. So, yes, anyone would get difficult to work with on that. That shouldn't be an issue that you should be riding behind, all men are pigs. Because the more divides that we have and the more inequality that we have, instead of actually sitting there and saying, hey, maybe we need to change the way Hollywood works. Maybe Hollywood shouldn't be about faces. Maybe we should go back to the days where it should be about talent rather than how good you look. Right, but the problem is we have become a society and culture that look at things as in, oh, what kind of a six pack this guy has, or oh, look at how good this guy's buns look like,
or
oh,
what's
look
familiar.
At his amazing hair. Yeah, and the thing is, I you know, even though Chris Hemsworth is a good actor, and I give him credit, he's a good
he's
actor.
Amazing in Rush.
I don't think he'd be as great as he is. He'd be in the position that he is if it wasn't for the fact that he looks amazing.
He'd be his brother Liam, basically.
Yeah. Well, there's another little chestnut that people seem to overlook, which is maybe, you know, equality, maybe not. I'm not, you know, going to talk about that. But the bottom line is these people are afforded a wonderful lifestyle and an amazing paycheck. And, you know, they're then biting the hand that feeds them, because that's what they're doing and talking about, you know, everything that's wrong with it. But they need to remember something, which is when you entered this career, because actors are some of the most, you know, people out there who have to slog and struggle. And I think Burhan can back us up on that, which is no one put a gun to your head and said, this is the career you had to choose.
Yeah.
You get a few movies under your belt and now you're going off on one. It's like, well, no, you're still in a position that is way beyond what, you know, your everyday person on the street would be.
Yeah.
Maybe it's right, maybe it's wrong, but I'm just saying,
it's the same thing.
You're still looking down upon something that people would dream about, and there are people out there who slog their guts out, never, you know, in that career, never get half the chance, well, not even one third the chance you get. So when you go on these big moral tirades, and as Burhan rightly said, which is you know kind of skit over some facts and emphasize other ones that aren't necessarily entirely true, you're missing the point that you're in a privileged position and no one told you you had to do it. So you don't like it, well then prove it, like you said, because of Robert Downey Jr. has been going for so long, well then prove it with your credentials.
One of my major goals as an actor, director, producer type person was to, and this is the thing, guys, now that this, if you don't take it from me, take it from someone who's basically been homeless because of his chosen career, okay? And I'm not saying that it's my, that, oh, you need to do a job or blah, 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 blah. Let's just skim over that. It takes a lot of passion to do what we do as an actor, as like a filmmaker or whatever you want to call it. And in any medium that you do, it's like the thing, I had a conversation recently, and one of the things that I kind of lost a friend over was when I said, when someone says the word, I'm producing, like, you know, with YouTube videos, Dave, when someone goes, I produce free content, you're welcome. I hate that. When someone says, you should respect me for what I do, you get paid to do your dream job. It's about how passionate you are about doing what you do,
and also,
and about how much
forget,
you love what you do.
In any walk of life, respect is something that is earned through your credentials, not something that you can just sit there and expect to receive because you think you're doing something that earns that right. No, that's not how respect works. That's in any aspect of life.
Yeah, and with me, is I've always wanted to define the industry and change it from the inside and be to the point where it's about the actors, you know, the men and the women who work on the films, who dedicate themselves and put a piece of themselves and leave it out there. You know, it's the same if you go into professional wrestling or if you're in Cirque du Soleil, if you're basically doing avant-garde theater. It's about the amount of pressure you put on yourself to be something and create something. That's what the arts are. And to define it in a way of like, I don't get paid as much as a uber talented, multi-talented human being who can probably out-act you with his little pinky. And it isn't as black and white, Dave. That's correct. It's become a lot more where you're basically, it's like you're going through a maze and you're just cutting through all those fucking bushes trying to find the exit. And that's what this has become now. You know, and the industry is transforming. It's becoming something more. And now at the moment, probably till 2020, it's going to be superhero movies. Then it's going to emerge into something else. And then we're going to be basically seeing actors on the next big thing, you know. And the way that I see it is, in order for us to actually understand and appreciate the industry, you've got to understand something when it comes to people, when it comes to those who entertain. And when it's not about gender, it's not about, and truthfully, and I'm going to say this, and a lot of people are going to be, oh, that's bullshit. It's not about color. Right, because as you can see, you've got a lead male in Star Wars now who's black.
We'll get to that in a bit.
You know, but yeah, that's gonna be a jumping off point after that. But you've got a lead male who's black. You've got like films led by Chinese guys. You've got films like, remember when we had the whole martial arts phase in the film industry where every single lead actor who's in a Chinese movie and a Hong Kong movie had their own movie in the United States and it bombed badly because they couldn't communicate properly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it changes.
And Jackie Chan overturned that stereotype.
It goes into phases. It goes into beats. It goes into different kind of tastes. And that's the thing, right? Eventually, the trends are going to change again and again and again. Mm-hmm. And a lot of this industry takes talent and luck. And 99% of the time, talent isn't actually the thing that gets you where you need to be. You know, it's basically your promotion, your PR, the way that people basically migrate to you and see who you are as a person. And the thing that people like Jennifer Lawrence...
I think what you could also add to this, Burhan, I don't mean to cut you off, just to say quickly, because I think it's relevant, which is with the way things are swings and roundabouts with what's popular and what's not popular in movie land is, it's called having your finger on the pulse.
Yeah.
That's not determined by necessarily the lead actor or, you know, the creed or colour or sexuality of the lead actor. That's just determined by what the public want to see at the time.
It's basically by the producers, by the people who make these movies and have their fingers on the pulse. 9 times out of 10, they're going to do it wrong, right? But sometimes they'll get that hit and that becomes the trend. Look at Paranormal Activity. I was talking to someone recently about the, how these movies probably cost about 500 grand to make, yet they say these movies cost millions to make.
I'm quite looking forward to the latest one, I will say that.
But they market them, they produce them, and they get them out. They're very cheap and easy to make, and they're very quick to kind of churn out, so they make enough of them. So if they make 100 million in the box office, bam. You know, that's a success story for Lionsgate. And that's where you've got to look at it, right? As an actor, as someone who basically, I pour my heart and soul into this industry, my blood, sweat, and tears. I've had mental breakdowns for this industry because I love it. And the thing that bugs me a lot is when someone sits there and pisses and moans because they're not number one. If you want to be number one, prove it.
Yes. Right?
But there was only a few people who can ever be that number one person. You know, you've got one of the world's greatest actors, and I'm going to point this out, who has never won a fucking Oscar, in Leonardo DiCaprio, right? But he has never once complained or moaned about his position in the industry. He's taken it on the chin, and he goes back to the drawing board and sees what he can do to make it work. Mm-hmm. So you know what, Jennifer Lawrence? I believe you're full of shit. I think your essay is full of shit. And for anybody that supports that, I want you guys to ask yourself a question. Have you ever really actually been a part of the industry instead of sitting there on your fucking high horse going, feminism?
No. Well, it's not a level playing ground. You've only got to look at things back in the day and look at the barriers that Bruce Lee broke down.
But nothing's ever going to be equal, though, Dave, because the problem is you have the actors who are at the high part of the totem pole and those who are at the lower point of the totem pole.
No, but that's my point, is he became the high part.
Yeah, he did it because he had something that no one else
but
had.
He had more going against him than people who, you know, piss and moan and whine about how unfair it is. He was clearly at the bottom of the ranks, particularly what Hollywood expects from its leading male.
Do you remember how they fucked him over for Kung Fu? Remember that?
Yeah,
and he never pissed about it. He just went, right, I'm just going to just prove myself. Prove yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Because at the moment, my respect level for you has gone down the shitter. And I really didn't have that much respect for you to begin with.
Are you saying
that
Jennifer Lawrence should go to Hong Kong? Sorry.
No, I believe that she needs to eat a fucking case of humble pie and sit there and say, hey,
oh, I agree.
Let me define myself. You know, Angelina, out of all the people that she listed on that, Angelina Jolie, and I want to talk a little bit about her just to end this little scenario off, because I've been ranting for quite a few minutes.
About a half hour.
Half hour. But I want to point this out. Angelina Jolie deserves a lot of my respect, and I can tell you why. And it's not because of what she's gone through personally, even though I think she's awesome for what she's done for personally, but she's used her fame in such a positive way. She's adopted children. She's basically alerted to like world hunger and all these other issues that have gone out, and she always puts on a performance. No matter how shitty the movie is, she's always managed to put a great A performance out there. Mm-hmm. You know, she deserves
Random tangent. Sean would like to join the call. I don't know who's hosting, so I can't.
Michelin or Walker?
Michelin.
Yeah, give him the come on.
Either way, I don't mind.
Whatever you guys want to do.
I'm just saying I'm not hosting, so I can't add him in.
Does he know we're talking Doctor Who?
Yeah, I told him.
Okay, let me bring him in a second. But
that's you know, for everything she is proven why she is one of the best veterans in the industry in terms of actresses. You know, same goes for Helen Mirren. Same goes for a litany of other actresses out there. Jodie Foster is another one. Who have proven themselves. And then you've got Jennifer Lawrence, who is a baby in consideration to the industry, who will sit there and moan.
And I'm going to throw my toys out my pram if I don't get it.
And yet people are cheering her on like she's the biggest spokesperson for feminism.
If you compare it to what Emma Watson said, and we'll get off this in a moment, but you compare it to what Emma Watson said, Emma Watson had focus and talked about real affecting issues.
Yeah.
If you look at what Jennifer Lawrence said, she just looked like a spoiled brat.
Yeah. I'm going to say this and then we're going to move on. If there is really a concern about there being some type of a system in place to protect women in Hollywood, and you're the highest paid woman in Hollywood, you have enough power to where you can actually change that. So I bring the challenge to Miss Lawrence. If you really do care that much about wanting to help women in Hollywood, set up a talent agency. Set up some type of service that can help people out. Actually do something with your power that you have, being one of the top-rated, you know, female actresses out there, and do something about it if you're really that passionate. But you're not.
She won't. Yeah. No, she'd rather she'll serve her own selfish needs than serve the needs of anybody else. And I guarantee you right now, we will probably never hear from Jennifer Lawrence after she's concluded her parts and her leads. And I've got a funny feeling a lot of it is because she's burnt so many bridges with this stupid essay, which has basically been her complaining about how much her fucking pay sucks in comparison to a man. Good job. Good job for making the divide of equality between male and females even more of that bigger gap, you know, just because the fact that you've basically just wanted to shit your own bed. Congratulations.
Well, yeah. I mean, she's probably still going to at least have the X-Men and Hunger Games franchises, but we'll see how it goes.
But kudos on the cloud pictures, because I really enjoyed them. So.
Yeah, and,
yeah, I could tell. Yeah. You were doing what you kind of did what Mick Foley, what happened to Mick Foley off the cage.
No, I enjoyed them in an artistic perspective. Thank you very much, young man.
And I just wanted to say we have Sean Michelin here on the line. Dave said that you suggested we bring him on. Sean, you there?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, I'm here. Yo, how's it going, dude?
Hell yeah.
Oh, not bad, man. Just long week and everything like that, and just been trying to get a lot of things done.
You're fading in and out, just as a heads up. Oh, I don't know if it's yourself.
Hold on now. Let me see if it's just...
He's got gout from watching his last picture. He's got gout from the amount of red...
Oh, yeah, the sausages? Yeah. Oh, there's moose. So, yeah.
Have you been sucking on too many sausages, Sean?
Yeah, I've been sucking. I've been biting them.
Yeah.
You'll never get equality that way, my friend.
Yeah.
No.
Speaking of equality, that's a good little dovetail to talk about the recent controversy over Star Wars and this ridiculous hashtag. Let me actually pull up the actual hashtag itself.
Yeah, they're going on Star Wars again.
Oh, God.
Yeah, they're saying that this hashtag movement is supposed to be trolling, isn't it? But I don't care what it is. It shouldn't be there in the first place.
It's kind of Poe's law at this point, to where you kind of have to put it's hard to put the line between trolling and who's serious, because I got to think that there's a lot in there.
There's probably a lot of people behind this who are... racist redneck fucks, and now I'm completely serious
yes.
about it.
Yeah, I think we found a bunch of Donald Trump supporters, I'll tell you that much.
Yeah.
Yeah. For those of you that don't know, somebody put out a hashtag on Twitter, hashtag boycott Star Wars 7, and the whole thing is about the main character, Finn, I believe that's his name in the movie, being black. That's literally the only thing.
And even if it is trolling, it's scary that so many people have jumped on it. Even if they're jumping on it for the joke perspective, or just to go, oh, I'm jumping on this because, you know, it's funny. It's still kind of a little bit scary. And
yeah. And the fact that they keep saying that the film is pushing an anti-white message. There's even tweets of saying about, quote, white genocide. And the fact that the movies are pushing a, quote, multicultural agenda. You know what? I maybe we're falling for it, talking about it, but... Like I said, it goes back to Poe's law. You know, is this you go so far with the trolling that it ends up sweeping around, you know, and biting its own ass in this case. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to say about this, because I think anybody who has a brain would probably see this as ridiculous, given the fact that the whole entire series up until this point has been nothing but white characters. Has anybody forgotten that?
But then you could also argue the other flip of the coin with, you know, the people who did this, you know, whether it's trolling or not, did this thing. Isn't there like another side of people who could have jumped in and just said the opposite, which is, if you notice that all the stormtroopers are white, this mass military force of people that, you know, inflict pain upon people, they're all white.
Dave, that's not how trolling works. Trolling works is you ignore the people with the correct answers and you just keep going. That's the point of trolling.
I like to piss them off, then I block them.
Yeah, that's basically what trolls do.
They get the last word and then block them.
They purposely piss people off, but like I said, I mean, given
the... like I said just then, and when Nick laughed, which is, as sad as this is, and if it is trolling or not, I'm pretty sure at least one third of the people who've backed this campaign are doing so because they agree with the subject matter, which is just terrible.
But that's the thing, and I agree with Dave on this. What the fuck is wrong with people, right? The thing is, I can understand the warranting in terms of casting against type. Sometimes you get it right, as in with Nick Fury, and also with Samuel Jackson when he was a badass fucking Jedi. Mm. And then, well, he played two roles there.
I don't think they cast against type. I think they did this deliberately to try and disassociate themselves, or it's no longer clones. Now it's army recruits.
Casting against type is a different thing. But then when you actually cast someone in a role which doesn't define, it's not defined by gender, right? The thing is, this is a new role. It's a universe that's expanded from an pre-existing universe, right? Mm-hmm. This point, when this person was on a pad, when the writers were writing this, this person had no gender. He or she had no identity. He had no character. This was given at the end after they went through the casting process. When you go through a casting process, when you decide who you want in your movie, you then decide on who the gender of the character is. This isn't a pre-existing character like Captain America or comic book character. These guys are new to the pre-existing Star Wars universe. So take a fucking chill pill and calm the fuck down, right? I don't give a shit if he's a man, woman, or if he's a fucking cat. As long as it's entertaining, as long as a great story is being told, and as long as it expands on an already great story that's pre-existing, stop complaining, stop moaning, and this whole keep it white bullshit. What are we in, the fucking like slave days? Seriously, do you want him to go pick cotton in a field somewhere? What the fuck is wrong with you people? Right, this is one of the hindrances of social media. Sometimes you need to back the fuck off from your keypad. Stop being a keyboard warrior. And even if you are trolling, get the fuck off. Because this is worrying. It just shows how blatantly racist you are and how stupid. And it goes for those same people who sit there and go, I agree with Donald Trump. Get a fucking clue, man. Seriously. Get a fucking clue. Because you sit there and you side with an idiot who sits there and goes on about fucking how evil and rapist Mexicans are when he's got factories in Mexico of people making his fucking suits, right? Yeah. And you sit there going, yeah, I agree with Donald Trump, or fucking anchor babies, right? When the man's family are from God knows what fucking foreign country, right? Mm. Come on.
The country of mismanaged hair, I believe.
Yeah, and the fact is, when now you're arguing over a character who seems really interesting. He seems extreme. I want to know who he is, because at
exactly. It's a plot device and a good one, and it's pushing it in a new direction. A fallen stormtrooper, you know?
When I saw the initial trailer when he was a stormtrooper, I'm sitting there thinking, oh, he's going to be like Han Solo or someone like that, you know? But that, now to know that he's the lead Jedi, I'm just like, whoa, how the fuck did this happen? So you get to see someone learning and fighting for something after he was was disassociated with something that he didn't believe in. I think that's a fucking great redemption story.
In any other movie, it's like a standard typical war movie going back to various wars such as World War II, World War I, or Vietnam, it would be applauded as a great departure from character. But now all of a sudden, because it's Star Wars, oh no, I've got sand in my vagina.
Yeah, and people forget that aside from the three main characters, the whole series has kind of been very diverse. I mean, you mentioned the whole stormtrooper things. Do we not remember how they established how all the stormtroopers are clones of Temuera Morrison from episode 2, who is Polynesian? So essentially, if we're going by that logic, yeah, all the stormtroopers are basically not white.
Well, and the logic I took from the fact that they've cast him it comes back to what Burhan said. This is a slight tangent, which is, you know, you don't know when you write a character, you don't necessarily know who they are, who they're going to be. They're not fully fleshed out at that point. You're just working out their lines. And while establishing the character, the creed is not necessarily involved at that point. So you've only got to look at the fact that Skywalker was originally called Starkiller. And it was originally going to be Han Solo in that role, wasn't it? So
yeah, and Darth Vader was basically going to be a bit part. He wasn't actually going to be like the main bad guy in the movie.
No, it wasn't even going to have an association. Yeah. It wasn't until he became a huge player in the movie that they had to rewrite the second script.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this is the thing. And believe it or not, this is basically a series that the Hollywood studios thought it was a piece of shit.
Yeah, it was a big movie.
That's why George retained all the merchandising rights and et cetera. So he made a fucking killing off of it.
Yes.
By the way, people, random fact, if you look at the original unedited, you'd have to do it on VHS now, the original unedited or re-cleaned up versions of Star Wars.
Fox versions.
You can actually see David Prowse's eyebrows through the eye goggles on Darth Vader. And they are big furry bastards.
Wasn't he the crossing guy when you guys are growing up or something? Tells you how to cross the street.
Oh, yeah, he was the Green Cross code man.
But that's the thing, when it comes down to it, you've got to look at it this way, right?
When Darth Vader tells you to cross the street, you cross the fucking street, trust me.
Nothing is basically set in stone. Let the movie happen, see how it goes. And I'm glad that the movie, in pre-orders, it's made over, what, 6.9 million?
Yeah, I believe that's what I was going to say.
It's made millions on IMAX as well, the IMAX releases.
Yeah. For all this, you know, trolling that's going on, it's just broken the record. It's outsold Superman versus Batman by like fucking 4-1 or something. And it's, yeah, like you said, Bernard, it's their pre-orders for tickets when you can book them in certain cinemas like IMAX is what, yeah, like you said, like $6.5 million.
I just want to see what the pre-orders are for Alvin and the Chipmunks: The Road Chip. I want to see what those pre-orders are.
Oh, my God.
The only other movie it's the only other movie premiering that same
got
Friday.
Balls. I got to say that.
I think the way the pre-order goes with that is that you register at a site and they pay you not to go see it.
Yeah.
You it's just like, know, though, don't you? Whoever maybe penciled in this slot because that's how their studio works and didn't realize what was coming up. Because obviously movies are shot so far in advance. You just know there was a room full of people in the executive lounge of that movie company when they saw that they were releasing Alvin against Star Wars, and a silent hush fell over the entire room, and then 15 people said at once, oh, fuck.
They may as well just get it out there. They may as well just silently release it and be like, well, we'll make it back in movie sales. Fuck it.
Oh, they could do what Austin Powers did and do a piss-take trailer to ride on his success.
But yeah, as far as the whole Star Wars thing, it's not going to do it any damage. I mean, Star Wars we're talking about. Even with this ridiculous hashtag, the movie's going to make more money than the Vatican, so I'm not worried about it.
I got
my Hot Wheels Millennium Falcon, so I'm happy.
I guarantee
this movie's probably going to make a billion in ticket sales.
Oh, no doubt. I mean, it's going to beat out Jurassic World.
It's going to be a gross domestic product in of it to itself.
Mm-hmm.
What the fucking profit margin on this is going to be.
I'm going to say it right now. I'm going to say at least it's going to be number two highest grossing. I can't say if it's going to beat Titanic or not. I don't know if it's going to beat Avatar. That's actually a bit of a challenge, but I could see it getting.
Well, isn't it basically it's Avatar then Titanic, isn't it, in the most successful movie?
Yeah, Avatar, then Titanic, and then Jurassic World. So I could see it beating Jurassic World, maybe Titanic, probably not Avatar.
Really disappointed with Jurassic World.
We talked about that.
I liked it, but
I liked it the first time I saw it, but then on subsequent viewing, I just went, this is not as good as the first movie.
It's good for what it is.
Yeah.
Basically. I do think it's been overhyped a bit too much.
It's a good greatest hits album. It's like buying a greatest hits album of your favorite band. You know what to expect. It hits all the right notes, but you're probably not going to go back to it, you know, unless you have to.
And sometimes it has those one or two exclusive iTunes tracks.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm talking about old school stuff, you know, like.
Yeah, I know. I'm just joking.
Yeah, but let's go on to one last bit of news that me and Burhan kind of had to talk about that we're a bit upset about.
Oh God!
A couple months back, it was announced that they were doing Die Hard 6. That Fox was dipping back into that franchise.
Didn't he say before Die Hard 4 on Letterman or something that he was never going to do another Die Hard movie because what would it be? It would be John McClane and a Zimmer frame.
Yeah.
Paycheck movie.
Yeah. I mean, that's what the fifth one was at this point, and it did make money. Yeah. It was not as big of a flop as I thought it was. I'm looking at the budget.
Die Hard 6 alimony payments.
Yeah. It's on a $92 million budget.
No.
What?
It's good. No, go continue with Miguel. No. It's even worse than that, Dave. But we should continue. Let Miguel continue.
The fifth movie on a $92 million budget did make $300 million, so I can't harp it on that. So they're dipping into it. Now, months back, we reported on rumors that they were going to bring back John McTiernan, or that they were going to try to bring back John McTiernan, who directed the first and the third movie. He was going to be brought back to revive the franchise. And there were also rumors that they were going to bring back the character of Zeus, played by Sam Jackson.
Mention if they're going to have Reggie Val Johnson back?
I don't know, but it would have been nice. I mean, it's McTiernan. So.
I liked this character. I did.
Oh, it's a classic character. You know, I like to think that they're actually in the same universe as his character in Ghostbusters and Family Matters. That it's basically what happened was he was living in New York when the incident happened. Then he moved to Chicago. Was it Chicago that Nakatomi Plaza Chicago. Was in?
Yeah, and where then Family Matters takes place as well.
Yeah. Basically, he used to work for the PD in Nakatomi Plaza, and then that happened. Like, there's a weird Reginald Vell universe theory out there. I'm pretty sure. But
Steve Urkel getting some help. John McClane getting some help from Steve Urkel device.
That'd be funny. But yeah, there was hope when I first heard the story about it. Like, you know, it was going to dovetail off of part three, and John McTiernan was back.
Yeah, Sam Jackson was coming back, and then they were going to basically do that buddy cop thing again. I thought it was going to be great. And then they did this.
Yeah, they just recently announced their plans for Die Hard 6, and I just had the link up, so let me actually pull that back up real quick. Let's see, where's my Die Hard 6 link? Shit, I don't have a Die Hard 6 link. Let me actually pull that up real quick. Live, everybody.
You linked it, didn't you link it on my, you linked it on my profile, didn't you?
Yes.
Well, basically, what they've done is they're now going to do it, whereas they're going to try and phase, it's going to be a soft reboot, so they're phasing Willis out and having a younger John McClane in it. So it's going to kind of be a prequel story, but having it jump back and forth.
Yeah.
Yeah. Me and Miguel, collectively just went.
No, but here's what really got me. I actually found the link. It's off of AV Club. I found the link that I sent to Burhan. Essentially, what it is, it's going to be a split timeline thing where it's going to take place with McClane in the present and him in the past, being played by a younger actor, obviously.
That's kind of, you know what, that's kind of interesting, though.
Here's the thing, though. It's based off of him being a secret agent of sorts. It's going to be him.
Now I'm lost.
Yeah, it's going to basically, let me see if I can find the line. Let's see. The film will devote most of its runtime to McClane's career as a cop in gritty 1979 New York. All the better to. Okay.
Oh, God, it's Life on Mars.
Yeah, that's why I went. I was literally, as soon as I heard that, I was like, Bowie.
Yeah, essentially what they're doing is they're trying to show the
ground control to John McClane.
This is the big problem that I have. It's basically,
this movie is going to be a pain.
No, let me get this out. Basically what they're doing is they're trying to set it up to where McClane in his early days was the diehard guy, you know, that he used to do stuff like this. And what I have a problem with is it goes against everything that the original character had. The whole crux of Die Hard and the whole crux of John McClane is he is a man that's just a regular guy. You know, he's got marital problems. He's an alcoholic. And he happened to fall into the situation where he had to do all these extraordinary feats of talent.
And also, let's not forget that the original movie is based on a short story.
Yeah, well, no, it's not a short story. Nothing Lasts Forever. It was actually a book. But the whole character of John McClane is,
Sinatra was supposed to be playing John McClane.
Yeah, because it's based on, because Nothing Lasts Forever is a sequel to The Detective, which Sinatra played that same character in 62 or the 60s.
Yes.
But essentially what it is the whole point of John McClane is he is just a regular guy put in a bad situation. He's not the transporter, which these movies nowadays have pretty much made him into. To try to write the character that he was this kind of character that would get into these situations completely goes against the allure of it. It goes against the spirit of John McClane. It's doing a damage not just to present day John McClane, which the series has done so far. It's completely
on the past.
Yeah, it's kind of retroactively rewriting the character, which is a bad idea. I'm sorry. And it wouldn't even be that bad if it wasn't for the fact that who's directing it. Because so far he's not signed on to direct, but apparently the studio is going to Live Free or Die Hard director Len Wiseman.
Was terrible.
Yeah, for advice. So he may end up directing this. And he's, for those of you who don't know about Len Wiseman's output, Underworld and the Total Recall remake. Those are his franchises. And he did do the fourth Die Hard movie.
Let's just promote my wife is what he's basically saying.
And well, maybe not for Die Hard, for the Die Hard franchise. But my point is he's a hack director. I'm not a fan of Len Wiseman. To me, he is Michael Bay light. He is Michael Bay without any flash or
the low-carb Michael Bay.
Yeah, like he...
He's a diet Michael Bay.
Yeah, he is diet Michael
Bay.
Michael
Bay, zero, more than likely.
Yeah, just one calorie, not good enough. But yeah, whereas Michael Bay at least has some type of artistic output, like you can tell there's an art form to what Michael Bay does. Weissman kind of just copies that style with no real finesse in his movies, and I'm not impressed. And if he's going to be the one that they're giving the franchise back to, we're essentially going to get Die Hard 4 Part 3.
Yeah.
And I'm so done. I hate the fact
that... We're actually going to get what it was called in this country, 4.0.
Yeah, it was...
The thing about it as well is this is going to single-handedly ruin Die Hard. Mm-hmm. That's the whole problem with this. And one, I think Bruce Willis is fed up with the franchise. He doesn't want to do it. It's a paycheck franchise.
Well, we know he's not. Yeah, he openly admitted, didn't he? With
And even casual. Kevin Smith said he's gotten to the point where if Bruce Willis doesn't respect you, he will do everything he can to fuck you. And
he could fuck me for $1 million. I'll even buy the lube.
I'm not
joking.
Let's not talk about Dave Wade's weird fantasies for $1 million. What Dave would do for $1 million. That's what we should turn the show into, what Dave would do for $1 million. Or in UK, if you basically like, you know, with transfers and fees, it would be $750,000.
That's the point, Burhan.
But the whole thing is, it's basically going to kill off the entire memory of what Die Hard was. And a lot of it was basically going to be where Bruce Willis is going to be throwing a half-assed fucking performance because he will not be up for this idea. Secondly, the other actor is going to be...
Get together, we'll have a few laughs. What's my line again?
Yeah,
we'll leave. And then we'll fix it in post-dub.
The other actor who's going to be basically playing with Willis is going to be brand spanking new and someone who's probably...
When you say being playing with Willis just sounds really creepy.
But the person is going to be as wooden as a cardboard box, because I guarantee you it won't be Joseph Gordon-Levitt. You know, it won't be someone who actually has the skill and talent to actually move forward with it. It's going to be some shithole who really can't do much.
It's going to be your Sam Worthington, your Jai Courtney, your Kellan Lutz type. Some
the guys
generic.
Who are very cardboard. You know, yeah. They look great, but they're cardboard, and you can see it. You know, with every bland performance they put off, and you're like, why do you even have a career again?
But they're cha-ching.
Yeah, but they're the guys who sit there, and every time they play a role, it's the same guy playing the same bland role with the same cardboard technique they have. And it's going to throw people off to the point where I can get... This will be Die Hard's Batman and Robin.
They should let me write the theme tune. I got it. Brilliant.
Apart from the fact that we're not going to see people mocking it and having fun with it because it's cheesy. We're going to see people mocking it and being vile towards it.
I wonder if it pisses them off that they can't get away with doing a remake. Like, I think that's what bothers them the most, is that they have to keep making sequels.
Yeah, because he won't allow it. Yeah, Willis won't allow it.
Yeah, I was just going to say, because Willis would be like, no, this is my paycheck, bitches.
Yeah.
Oh, he's like, you either continue it or you don't do it at all. And yeah, I think he's hoping that they kill it off.
But at this point in his career, if he was a cop, he'd be edging towards retirement anyway, and he'd be in a desk job.
I wonder. No, I'm actually going to ask to say this. I wonder if he's going to try to negotiate it the same way Heston negotiated coming back for Planet of the Apes 2, whereas I'll come back, but you have to kill me. And I wonder if that's going to be.
Oh,
he
won't do that. Ego.
No, I think he's done. Like, I think at this point he's just tired, and it's like, I don't want to fucking do these movies anymore. I don't want to come back, but they're going to pay me because they want my name on the marquee. If I was him, I'd be like, I'm done, dude. Like, give me the least amount of time possible for the script and just kill me off. And, yeah, I'll come back for whatever.
So what you're basically saying is it should be ground control to John McClane.
Shoot
me in the brain so I don't have to do this franchise again.
Well, I think they should do it kind of like the old cliche where it's like, they shoot him and kill him off like 3 days before retirement.
Damn!
3 days away from retirement.
I used to see you. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean,
the thing is, I'm not happy about this movie. I'm probably gonna watch it when it comes on DVD or maybe Netflix.
I didn't hate the last movie. We talked about this when we did our retrospective. I didn't hate the last movie, but it was a good, you know, it wasn't a perfect. It was a good, solid action movie. But it wasn't a Die Hard movie. The heart of the Die Hard franchise went out after the third movie, as far as I'm concerned. Then everything after that just felt like Bruce Willis just going, oh, someone just write me a fucking paycheck.
I don't, you know, I thought four was goofy and I couldn't finish it just because it suffered from premise failure. But
it was just long in that one, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was just been long in that one. I can see why people like that one. And I said in the review is if that was just done as a one-time experiment, like a short-lived revival of the franchise, I wouldn't have an issue with it. I'd been like, okay, it's a thing that happened. I still have these three movies. We can, you know, disregard that one. But the fact that it just kept going. And I do have to ask, Dave, which version did you see? Did you see the 12 version or the unrated version?
Unrated version.
Okay, because you guys will probably end up getting a censored down version over in the UK because we got the R-rated version of 5 over here and you guys got the 12 cut.
Yeah, I watched...
You had to get it on Blu-ray to get the uncensored one, so...
I watched Die Hard 4.0, and I think the best thing about that movie was...
We had the best title, though. I will say this. We had the best title, because Live Free, Die Hard...
It made more sense.
I know it was a license plate, but the thing is, Die Hard 4.0, to me, at least just matched up what the movie was about, which was cybercrime.
Fucking internet, yeah, cybercrime. Fucking... And you know, the thing that kind of... Like, I didn't mind Die Hard 4, but then when they went with Die Hard 5, I just sat there and I was like, what is this?
It's a Bourne movie that happens to have Bruce Willis in it. That's what 5 is, essentially.
It was Bourne if you take away all the subtext and character, you know, development. That's what that was. I just sat there,
Bourne idea and
there were good moments. Just on a whole, it wasn't a Die Hard movie.
Yeah.
Plus, they completely butchered one thing that would make it a Die Hard movie, which was at least in the PG-13 cut. at the end, when instead of saying "Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker," he went "Yippee-ki-yay," and then there was a big explosion.
It was a gunshot.
Yeah, which we clearly knew what he was going to say. And you're like, really, really?
Do they fix that in the 4.0 cut?
I think they do. It's been a while since I've seen it. It's certainly in the deleted scenes, but that's his fucking calling card. You don't fucking stop McClane from saying "Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker." That's like, I don't know, telling fucking Mr. Bean that he can't be a fucking klutz.
Here's the thing, though, when it comes to ratings, if you put an ER at the end of the word fuck, it makes it an R rating. You can have one word that says fuck in a PG-13, but if you add an ER to the end,
surprised. this isn't a tangent, but I'm just going to say, I was quite surprised that in the original release of X-Men Days of Future Past, you got that brilliant scene with Xavier when he goes, I seem to recall you. And I'm going to say to you what you once said to us. Fuck off. And he says it with such venom. And my brain actually remembers thinking at the time, which is, can you say that? Like, in a PG-13? Yeah.
You get it
Johnny Knoxville movie, The Ringer, is another example there. And I actually watched it with the commentary on. And it was the part where, the guy had taken them out to some stuff. And he said, oh, yeah, I took them out to ice cream, too. And Buddy just goes, when the fuck did we get ice cream? And the commentary, the Farrelly brothers go, and there's our PG-13.
See, that'd be really... I really like the list of things you can and can't do in a PG-13 or, in this country, a 12-rated movie, which is not just necessarily violence, but the language that you can use.
I also want to bring up a bit of a tangent that some guys on a podcast were talking about. They were doing... they were talking about this the new season of American Horror Stories. And they talked about how essentially, are any of you guys fans of American Horror Stories?
I haven't.
I'm not the fan of a current season with Lady Gaga.
Yeah, they talk about her in it and how basically she's almost like nearly naked through the whole entire series.
Yeah, it's just her.
Yeah, and they made a good point. It's like, okay.
Can you see a winky in it?
No, but they made a good point.
You know, she's got a winky. I'm just saying, it's the elephant in the room. She's got a winky.
No. She suffers from like China syndrome, where it's just really large. But unfortunate, in her case, it's not steroids.
Large. Anyway,
going back to what I was saying. One hell of a they talk about how it's like she's essentially like 97% naked, and they were like, "Why is that allowed?" Like, if you're gonna cut that much of a strict line when it comes to nudity on TV, it's like, okay, we can't see 100% of you naked, but we could see 97% of you naked. Like,
thank God.
Well, that's the watershed.
You're winky.
Yeah. It's like,
this is the thing as well. It's very Gaga-esque, and what bothers me about it so much is, she has no conceivable acting talent, and people keep casting her in shit.
She wears a meat dress really good. Sorry.
Yeah, but it's like, oh, but she's freaky, and that's what we want in American Horror Story.
No, it's because American she's Horror Story is not popular. Supposed to be.
But that's the thing; it's not supposed to be about what's hot. It's about, the thing is in Hollywood, there's the age old adage, where they try and get someone who's popular and put them in a movie so their fans migrate over to that movie. They tried to do it with Nicki Minaj and the other woman; it bombed. They tried to do it with 50 Cent and all his other projects; it confused people because it made him think that he was naturally an actor.
And now he's a bankrupt, broke ass.
And that bombs.
He's skinny, right? Too.
Yeah, now he's worth then, about 50 cents, I guess.
Boys are fucking expensive.
I tell you what, though, it'd be brilliant. If he was an English rapper, do you know what he'd be called? 50p.
There you go. But do you know what I mean? It makes you sit there and think, okay, you've got all this shit that they're doing, and it doesn't work, but they still keep doing it, hoping that it would change. It's like someone on the committee is probably just sitting there going, hey, guys, we did this before. Didn't work. So let's try something else.
It'll work again, damn it.
Do you know what's great? Lady Gaga. It's like they've got Vince McMahon in the fucking, like...
Bingo!
Production team. It'll work again, damn it.
Well, here's the thing. It has worked in the past. It has. You know, I remember this young white rapper that, you know, was doing his thing, and he was popular, and then they started putting him in movies. I think the guy's name was Marky Mark something. I don't remember what his name was, but
no, it was Robbie Van Winkle.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Vanilla Ice.
Me too.
Go, Ninja, go.
And I'll explain to you about Mark Wahlberg, and I'll explain to you why that's different. Mark Wahlberg went from an underwear model to a rapper person.
Boy band. He was also in New Kids for a little while.
He was in New Kids for like a cup of coffee.
No, not Mark Wahlberg. That was his brother.
Danny.
Mm.
Yeah. No, Mark was in New Kids as well.
Early on, very early, like first album.
And I was a huge fan of him, being too good looking to the rest of the freaks. When I was a kid, I actually
finish this sentence, Burhan.
Anyway, but going on from that, you know, he was doing that, and then he kind of repackaged himself, disappeared for a while, and then came
back. Based on his underwear commercials, repackaged himself, no pun intended.
But repackaged himself as an actor and went into like the film industry, and he was taking bit roles here and there. And just started developing his career. That is so fucking different than putting Nicki Minaj in a movie and watching her like paint dry. I mean, in The Other Woman, she's standing there doing this. I can't believe they did that. And I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with your face?
Paint dry is, you know, a great analogy for how much fucking makeup she wears.
We could also bring up the likes of Dwayne Johnson, who was kind of in the same boat. I admit what you're saying, and it's very again, big extremes, but at the same
But the thing is, there was only so much they could do by using the name value. His career bombed, and then he reinvented himself as an action hero.
To an extent, but like I said, like they look at the successes of guys like Mark Wahlberg and Dwayne Johnson, and they think, you know, we can manufacture that. We don't have to wait until these guys blossom on their own, like Johnson and Wahlberg did. We can manufacture it while they're still hot. And I haven't seen much of the new season of American Horror Stories, but I just wanted to bring up the whole fact of, you know, it's like, what's the difference between 100% nudity and like 95%, which is what this one is? There's a lot of people
I can answer that for you. Good sir. Bad.
What, hair?
You don't get to see bush.
Yeah.
You don't get to see nipples, and you don't get to see JJ.
Yeah, but what's the difference? Yeah. What's the difference between what's the difference between seeing the rest of the body? Like, I don't get.
It's basically like the start of a James Bond movie. You know it's there, and you can see it, but you can't quite see it.
You can call her pussy galore, but you can't see her pussy galore.
Unfortunately. But yeah, I just wanted to bring that up. But yeah, we've talked enough about Die Hard 6. It is what it is. It's going to be a thing that happens. And hopefully...
Do you think it's going to be successful?
No.
I think it's going to do less money than the fifth one. And the fifth one made $300 million worldwide. I think this is going to do less. I would be shocked if this movie is a success. I think at best it'll be a disappointment. And that's it. That depends on how much money they put into the budget. If they can keep it a low budget, it might be a success. But this is Hollywood we're talking about. I don't think that they'll
I'd like to see, if we could go back about 15 years, I would have really liked to see Right, it would have been incredibly exaggerated, but I guess technically Die Hard movies were. But can you imagine a Die Hard movie 15 years ago that was directed by John Woo? Oh, that would be fucking
sexy. Oh, my
Christ. Do you know what I would say, right? I think Die Hard movies were great when they were Die Hard movies.
Die Hard sounds like your Viagra's just run out, by the way. Sorry.
When they started turning them into, like, just any old type of movies, it kind of killed it.
Well, here's what killed Die Hard is Die Hard. If you look at the cinematography on Die Hard, it's still one of the most beautifully shot action movies I've ever seen. I mean, even taking into account like John Woo stuff, I mean, it is just so.
Even 2 has great cinematography, like the bit when he's stuck in the vent and shit.
Yeah, I mean, I know that Jan de Bont really hasn't done much in his career. He ended up doing Speed and Speed 2. But his cinematography work as director of photography is amazing.
I'm glad you clarified the movies because I thought you were going to say he got stuck, you know, addicted to amphetamines.
No, Jan de Bont, I should have said The Haunting remake because he also did that one, unfortunately. But yeah, as a cinematographer, Jan de Bont's work on Die Hard is amazing. And there's nobody out there anymore that does that kind of slow, intentional cinematography where you get a good scope.
In a movie ever for great underplayed comedic scene, which is when the SWAT team is about to rush in the front of Nakatomi, and you've got the bloke behind, you know, he takes his MP5 and he runs behind the vending counter, and he's holding his MP5 up, waiting for the SWAT team to come in, and then he looks down, then he looks forward, raises his gun, then he looks down again, and then you see him reach down for a Twinkie. Oh, genius.
Yeah, it's just subtle, very subtle cinematic cues, and there's no subtlety anymore in film. So that's why Die Hard movies have been able to last the test of time, and that's why I honestly don't think a John Woo Die Hard would have worked. I think you would have lost a lot of that. Woo's,
it would have worked 15 years ago.
Woo's film style was too quick at that point. His
despite what anybody says, man, I love Face Off.
I think that movie for what it was.
Killer and Hard Boiled. Can you imagine a Die Hard movie that had an end sequence like The Killer? Oh, Christ.
In the hospital.
I've got a semi already thinking about that.
Speaking of Hard Boiled, have you ever played the video game sequel, Stranglehold?
Yes, it's not bad.
I actually like it.
For a minute, Miguel, my heart fell then because I thought you were just going to say, speaking of Hard Boiled, you know they're going to make a remake. And my brain just went, oh, what? What? Oh, God, no.
No, they don't know. Hollywood would never know how
to do a movie.
Stallone
wanted to make a remake of Killer for a few years, didn't he?
He did the remake of Get Carter.
We won't talk about that piece of shit. Seriously, I watched that. And
wasn't
I was
Michael
like,
Caine in the remake as
well?
Yes. Michael Caine was sitting there going, I did it for the money.
Yeah.
See, don't you make right a here, blood check, remake
he cut
out me.
This is what I fucking did it for. Right here. And I'm praying. Yeah.
He knows he's got Batman in his back pocket. But anyway, let's going off of something that's British, let's go on to our main event topic, which
don't
we
talk
were
about our teeth.
We were originally going to talk. We were originally going to talk Highlander last week, but given the change and the fact that this is going to be the last episode of the series, we decided to do an episode that I've been pushing for months now. And finally, having gone far enough into the series, we can finally talk about. It's going to get geeky, folks, because we're talking Doctor Who.
Oh boy!
And I want to get you guys' viewpoints on it because you, Dave, and Burhan, you guys over there, it's way more of an institution than it is here. I mean, it kind of became...
We're coming up to Christmas as well, so we get the great Christmas feature-length episode. Sorry.
It was one of those things where it came out, it was a great hot thing for a while, and then some idiot director-controller came in and was like, let's get rid of it because it's shit.
Well, no, the BBC, it became too expensive for the BBC, and it was a cheap show to begin with. But
They axed it in 1989. Right, just say this, then we start at the beginning. They axed it in 1989 because the BBC producer at the time who was hired openly admitted while he liked sci-fi, he didn't like Doctor Who. So Doctor Who got cancelled with Sylvester McCoy in 1989, but they still went on and made a lavish sci-fi series based on the White Mountain books, which was the Tripods.
He's actually my favourite Doctor, by the way, McCoy. They did try bringing it back as well when they decided to do it with NBC, who the Americans didn't understand it because they Americanized it a bit too much.
Which I always thought was weird because at least when I went on holiday in the States as a kid, and from what I know of the States, and I'm an English person, so obviously it's not a lot, but Doctor Who has always been, you know, at least on PBS and in Canada, a a stalwart of sci-fi across the world. So I was quite surprised that that, you know, pilot episode never took off.
Yeah, well, it was for
shame, because
well,
Paul McGann was a fucking brilliant doctor.
Here's the thing.
The dude as the master was terrible.
Wasn't the master Eric Roberts?
Yeah, Eric Roberts. Yeah, he was just, ugh.
Really? Eric Roberts?
Actually brought back his original cloak, or the original master's cloak, from Gallifrey. So, you know, there was nods to the original, you know, 60s TV series in it, where Eric Roberts had the original cloak when he got reformed into, you know, the master after he was Ooze. Don't ask people, it's complicated.
We'll get to the master when we get towards the end of this, because I have a few things I want to say about that story arc.
Oh, we're talking about the reboot. It's not a reboot, because it's still in continuity, isn't it?
Yeah, the revival in 2005, because that's as far as I've gotten. I started with the 05 revival, and I'm three seasons
in. You do need
in.
To go back at some point, by the way.
Eventually, but I've also got Torchwood and the Sarah Jane Adventures planned, so I've got a long ways to go.
Basically, the series was kind of an institution. They cancelled it. They tried bringing it back, and when they tried bringing it back, I liked it, because I'm kind of a sucker for all things American, I'm not going to lie. And then they
had one of my favorite scenes ever, which is when the doctor explains the breakdown between the real physical world and, you know, what the master is trying to do to it. And he does that thing where he puts his hand through the window with the plate glass doors and then steps through it to explain to the American nurse that, yeah, guess what? Your world's fucked.
And she was like the first American companion as well.
It's got that great scene when he rides into a bad guy rides into the TARDIS on a motorbike, and then turns around and rides straight back out.
Yeah, I do want to point out the fact that 1996 pilot was done for Fox, so it doesn't surprise me that it failed, because Fox has always done that to hard sci-fi.
That's a big deal in this country. I remember it was exclusive to Sky TV, which is the main satellite company.
Yeah, because BBC they refused to air it, didn't they?
Yeah. And so it was on Sky, and I remember with my mate, you know, sitting down, and we had popcorn, we had beer, we had fucking all kinds of treats, and we were like, yes, Doctor Who's back. It's been like, what was that? Was that 96?
It was 96, yes.
1996.
So Doctor Who'd been off the air since 1989 at this point, so it was like a really, really big deal.
It was. And then McCann basically became the longest reigning Doctor.
For comics, audiobooks, and novels.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And up until basically, because they were going to spin this off into a series of its own, because it was going to be like a feature that turned into a backdoor pilot for a series. That didn't happen. It's kind of the same thing they did with Torchwood at one point as well, but, you know, when you come to that bridge, you'll see.
I want to get to Torchwood soon, just because of...
So, they basically decided to bring it back, and this time they brought someone else as the Doctor, who is a gentleman by the name of Christopher Eccleston, who's someone that I kind of adhere to. You know, I have like kind of a...
He did shit on the franchise, though. I mean,
there was a reason behind it, but we can go into that in a little bit when we get to the end of his run.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, from when he started, I loved him. He was a very gritty Doctor. He was a different Doctor. He wasn't a Doctor that we have ever seen before.
Well, that's technically true, Burhan, because he did have some...
He had
some similarities to Sylvester McCoy,
he had that presence that McCoy had, but in regards to his look, he was very modern.
Well,
you know,
why that was the case, right? He purposefully said, I did not want any fancy clothes because I didn't want the clothes to make the Doctor. He saw how previous Doctors before him... You know, when people remember them, they think of...
scarf from Tom Baker.
Tom Baker's scarf. Yeah. Who was the Doctor that had, like, the weird clown suit? Like, there was one that was just this gaudy-looking...
Colin...
I think it was the fourth or the fifth Doctor, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. It was after Tom Baker.
Oh, you're talking about Austin Powers suit?
Yeah, there was one that had, like, a bizarre, like, weird...
Sean Pertwee.
Let me actually look into that, because I know there's
Sean Pertwee dressed like Austin Powers. Austin Powers was actually, his suit was actually based on an amalgamation of Bond and Sean Pertwee as the Doctor.
And Sean Pertwee's son is currently Alfred in the new Gotham series.
Oh, no, the sixth Doctor.
Colin, Colin Baker?
Yes, his suit. I'm looking at a picture of it. It is hideous. It's just all of these different.
His regeneration, though, is so dark. So dark. It's. Yep.
I'm sure that's one thing
I would say, Miguel. Look it up just to see Colin Baker's, you know, well, Peter Davison into Colin Baker. His regeneration is super dark because when he comes back, they kind of did a thing they did with, sorry, people, spoilers. They did with Matt Smith after Tenant, which is it's like it's almost like his memory was wiped and he gets really confused and he almost tries to throttle his assistant.
Well, I'll have to look into that, but yeah. Eccleston did not want to fall into that same trap of being typed by his look. So he straight up asked. He wanted just the flat black coat, jeans. He wanted the performance to elevate the Doctor, not
he has the greatest line in the world ever in that series, which is one? Oh, anyway. You're from space, but you sound northern. Well,
every place, even space has a north.
Yeah.
I do like that. And I do like Eccleston. He's still my favorite Doctor because, yes, he had that foppish quality to him, but I took him seriously when things got serious.
Yeah, because he was always very technical. He was always the first to jump into the fire. And he was a great understudy. He was a Doctor that showed
up. He was an action hero compared to the last Doctors, even though they, you know, kind of fought, you know, injustice and shit like that. He was an action hero, like you said, Ben, which is he jumped into the fray.
Yeah, and he broke down the barriers for what the character is because he made the Doctor more of an everyman. He wasn't just some smart ass who looked like a Panto character. He was an everyman. He was like you, he was like me, and it opened the door to go for the new Doctors that were coming through because it changed the kind of quality of who he was. You know, from back when he was like in the old series, he seemed like this pervy old dude who kept getting young women to follow him everywhere.
By the way, I just read some information about the first season. Do you know the other two actors that were in the running for the Ninth Doctor that almost got it had Christopher Eccleston not gotten it?
Wasn't one Peter Firth?
No, one of them is listed that I'm not familiar with, an actor by the name of Alan Davies.
That would have been amazing!
Yeah, apparently he... can you tell me a little bit about him? I'm not too familiar with his...
He's actually a stand-up comic. He's on... you can find it all over YouTube. He's on a satirical panel show called QI.
Who's that?
Alan Davies.
Alan Davies, yeah.
Yeah, and he also acts, and he had a brilliant show where he was a... Was it magician slash and or detective?
Was it Jonathan Creek? Is that the one that you're talking about? Yeah, because I do see it listed. But yeah, he was in the casting. But do you know who else was? And I don't know if he would have been good. I think he would have been too big of an actor to have put in that role. Nothing against Eccleston not being a big role, but this guy probably would have been a lot bigger. Bill Nighy was up for the role.
Wow, that would have really worked.
Let me
put this out to you people in North America land. If you don't know who Bill Nighy is, he's the
he's stepdad. Davy Jones in Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah, he's the stepdad of Sean from Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah, he's
at the same level, though, I think, like, it gave the Doctor a bit more character development by having Eccleston.
Yeah.
With all these other guys, you're casting them in the same role as who the Doctor was before and who he was prior. And by doing that, you're basically casting a dated character back into the same role again.
Yeah, and I'll get more into that when I get into Tenant.
It's funny, I've said it before. I said it on an episode of Burhan and the Boy, and I'll say it again. What I really liked about Eccleston was he was the Doctor, and he knew it was his place to guard the planet Earth. But there was very much this element of his character, which is fine, I'll guard you, I'll protect you, I'll save you. But ultimately, you're a species beneath me, and I don't like you. And I really like that element.
Yeah, this was a Doctor that I liked about him because he, more than any other Doctor I've seen so far, he was the Doctor that's seen shit. Like, his entire story arc about doing what he did during the Time War, he wears that on his sleeve through the whole first series, and I do like that. He's a troubled Doctor.
And it also has that really, really nice wrap up at the end, doesn't it? When he regenerates.
Is it really a spoiler at this point to say the Doctor regenerates? Like, well, is that really
I'm just, I'm just protecting, you know, fair people enough. Out there. But has that brilliant scene at the end, which is he's been a complete badass doctor for the entire series. He was completely badass in, you know, the whole, and this is what I love about Doctor Who, when they brought it back with the, like, the bad wolf thing, which is, when you saw the final episode and you thought, like, where did that come from? Then you watched all the episodes before it, and there's these little hints here, there, and everywhere, whether it was spray paint on a wall.
Understand that this Doctor isn't the Doctor that we knew and loved.
Yeah.
He was a very hardened Doctor.
Where you get kind of the fact that he is the Doctor, I at least interpret it as a throwback to the Doctor we love, or the Doctors we love, at the end where he absorbs the radiation from Rose, and he says that line. What was it? You were brilliant. You were brilliant.
Fantastic.
Yeah, but so was I. And then you're like, that's when you see it took the final episode for you to see the compassion that you saw in previous Doctors. And boring random fact about that scene was the BBC didn't know, because they cast him on a 1-year contract. They didn't know that he wasn't going to come back. And so they shot the final episode, and then he told them, I'm not coming back. I don't want to be typecast, which I always find ironic because...
No. That's actually not the way it went down, if you actually read his interview.
Well, I saw the interview he did on Breakfast TV, so whether that was just him...
he basically was a cock before then, and for the final... There were days where he wouldn't even come in on set, and they had to basically work around it. And because
but what
Billy
I'm saying
Piper
is
was,
they had to
know.
Shoot the regeneration scene was shot a couple of months after the final episode, and I would love to see it, and they didn't put it in the special features because there is an original ending to the final episode of that season that we never got to see, where it was ended out that he was going to come back in the next season. So that would be really cool to see.
Well, so he was going to be there, but... Oh, because it... Basically, he wasn't going to regenerate. He was going to continue the role.
Yeah, he was going to. Yeah, he planned on coming back. So now we know some of the, like, you know.
Yeah, he said he walked away from it. Yeah, he walked away from it due to the politics and everything. And
but he walked away after the final scene was shot, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, he basically said the reason why he did that was because the way they were treating people. He didn't like the way they were treating people on set. He said there was bullying going on in the BBC. There was stagehands who were being mistreated. And this is a guy who was dying on his hill, you know? He died on his hill for people. And he went out all out there and went nuts, you know, and basically said that he had enough. And Billie Piper, they made her stay behind. She wasn't getting paid as much as he was. And he was basically, he said he took a chance because after he did that, he got blackballed from the BBC. They wouldn't allow him to do anything else. They wouldn't work with him on anything.
And he was a stalwart. Before this, he was a stalwart at BBC. What was the show he did when he was the regeneration of Christ? Do you remember that? Yeah.
And he couldn't get work. And he said he basically took everything and he moved to the States. You know, he had literally nothing.
You mentioned Rose before. You're more familiar of Billy Piper's history as in
Do
entertainment.
Do you have a boyfriend? Is he really cool? Can I get a number?
Ew, that sounds awful. Ew, just kind of singing that sounds awful.
That was Billy Piper. She was a 15-year-old girl who got
popular. And then our Chris Evans dated her. And do you know how he pulled her when he was like a 37-year-old male and she was like 16?
Yeah, he bought her a Porsche.
He bought her a Ferrari.
That was it.
So what was the reaction when
Chris Evans wants to buy me a Ferrari, I'd totally buy him.
Well, going back to what I was saying, what was the initial reaction?
I spent their entire marriage getting drunk. Do you remember that, Dave?
Tabloid. You got to remember as well. Billy Piper was all over, mainly thanks to Chris Evans. Our Chris Evans was all over the tabloids. Everywhere she went, people took pictures of her. Some of them not so flattering when she was absolutely plastered. But yeah, that's how you were a bird in this country. You get her absolutely wankered on booze.
So
basically, she reinvented herself after she divorced the guy because. after being married to him.
Nowadays, though, I'm not. And if you take it for what it was, you know, Diaries of a Cool Girl, which was great because we got to see her jubblies. But I respect her as an actress now. I really do.
I don't. I think she's shit.
That's because she never bought you a Ferrari, you prick.
No, she goes from the David Tennant Doctor Who school of acting, and I don't mean Tennant shit because he's okay, but in terms of her acting ability, she
David
shows
Tennant is the greatest doctor in the world.
Ooh, we'll get to that.
I disagree on that one, Dave.
We'll get to that when we get to.
But
Tennant.
She has that toothy grin and the kookiness that she retains, and she does it with everything she's ever been in. And I want to
punch her in
the face.
Yeah, but that was the writing. That's not her fault.
That's fucking character. That's her character. She put that fucking thing in there.
She had great hair, so shut up.
It's like saying, oh, it wasn't the Hitler's fault. No, it was Billy's fault. Hang on a minute,
Burhan. I don't recall that Piper killed the Jews.
Well, she could have with that fucking crappy acting. Anyway, she came out. She did this character. At the time, she was a brand new actress. She declared on television, if you remember, Dave, with some PR, that she was going to be an actress again and she wanted to be an actress. And then suddenly she was in the running to be the Doctor's new sidekick. And they set this girl up as Rose. And I remember the first thing you said to me, Miguel, is, she's not that bad. The problem is, they kept bringing her a bigger role and giving her a bigger role.
Yeah.
And her a bigger role.
They wrote her character off, but they always brought her back. You haven't yet seen that, Miguel.
I just finished Partners in Crime, where she, spoiler alert, makes a slight appearance. So I'm looking forward. I'm looking forward in quotation marks.
Oh, expect
to see
a
where
lot
she
more.
Comes in, yeah.
Which Although she was brilliant. Sorry, people, spoilers. She was brilliant in the 50th anniversary episode of The Doctor.
Oh, as the what the fuck was her name?
But that
the
was
moment?
Probably because she didn't play her character.
Her and what
played.
The fuck is her name? I like that.
Yeah, I couldn't remember what because there's so many these in the Doctor.
Was the conscious interface device for the weapon.
Yeah, and Moffat didn't want to bring her back because he didn't want to. He said that he had too much respect for the Bad Wolf story arc and how it was Russell T. Davies' baby. So he was like, I know people are expecting her to come back, but I can't do anything that'll rewrite the way Davies wrote his. So
the problem is they made her such a big part of the fucking thing that it got to the point where she went from
They stopped writing it for themselves and they started writing it for the fans.
Yeah, and the sidekick should never be like bigger than the Doctor. Yeah. You know, that's
I always enjoy Tennant's episode. I know we'll get to that, but I always enjoy Tennant's episode when he had no sidekick.
Yeah, the whole chemistry between the two was he learns from her, she learns from him.
I actually want to talk about chemistry more so when we go into the differences between Rose and the Ninth Doctor and Rose and the Tenth Doctor, because there is a difference. And I do want to go into that, but I do want to save that for when we get to Tennant.
Basically, Eccleston was kind of more of the gritty type. You got Rose Tyler who came in. At first, you had a bit of character development because she was a clean, new character. I disliked her from the moment I saw her because she had a boyfriend played by a gentleman that I knew.
New as in you've actually worked with the guy? Noel Clark?
Noel Clark. I've actually talked to him a couple of times. He was a friend of a friend, so we traveled around the same circles.
It's weird when it comes to Mickey because on the one hand, I can sympathize with him, but at the same
because
time
his
that
girlfriend dumped him on his fucking ass after finding
Which
the doctor.
Right
but hold on, hold,
with
hold on,
Who.
Hold on,
Let's
hold
not
on.
Forget that.
I have to
but
say
the thing
this.
Is, he actually has better character development than she does.
Oh yeah. In the first season though, he's so pouty. Like I just wanted to punch him in his face every time I saw him because I wanted to sympathize with him, but he was just so much like, I'm not as good as the doctor.
Yeah.
That was basically every time he talked in that first season.
I demand an intro for my videos based on that.
The doctors stole my girlfriend.
By the way, you could have done that impression for him and also Jennifer Lawrence just saying, I didn't get enough.
Just go full Joey from the Yu-Gi-Oh! American dub.
I just don't get enough then, like, I just don't get as much as Robert Downey Jr. Anyway.
Needs more Brooklyn rage.
The next time my cash card doesn't work at the self-scan, I'm totally using that.
Your self-scan.
But you know what? I'll say this: Mickey really does redeem himself when during the final few episodes in the second season. His character arc really comes full circle in my opinion. And I really do want to watch
them out because they did a survey and it turned out that almost 3/4 of the British public who watched Doctor Who actually preferred him to the Doctor.
Yeah, they did. And the thing is, he was a very strong character. He was a character at the first. He was a bit moany. But once Tennant's time came around, he became a stronger character. And I love the story they had where he basically got in touch with his kind of other self.
Yeah,
and how he became stronger.
Oh, the Cross Stream episode. That was brilliant.
Yeah, that was Rise of the Daleks, I think. No, yeah. Not Rise of the Daleks, Rise of the Cybermen.
Yeah. And he became stronger because his other self, he watched his other self die. And his other self was calling him a fucking pussy and that. It was fun to watch, having a very diverse range of characters. And it was something that Noel Clarke played really well. And it was something that I felt made him stand out. And I liked him as kind of a de facto psychic to Billy Piper's character, who was always a moany bitch. I mean, literally, she was a moany bitch.
Here's the thing about Rose, and I guess we'll talk about this when it comes to the chemistry. I think the reason why Rose was not as bad in the first season as she was in the second season is because the Ninth Doctor knew how to keep her in line. He knew how to – he didn't put up with her stupid shit, whereas – the 10th Doctor kind of enabled it, so there wasn't that sort of back and forth where Rose would say something stupid or do something stupid, and the 9th Doctor would kind of pull her chain back and be like, no, that's not how you do it. The 10th Doctor would be like, all right, I'll go with you. Woo!
Kind of. It was like, you know, let's be kids and have kids stuff and do a kids party. And it was literally when Tennant came over. I remember the first thing that made me go, and that was where he went, at least I'm not Ginger. I was like, oh, for God's sake, why? Why are you doing this?
Sir, you're a racist.
No, it was just like, you're too kooky. I expected him to still retain that hard edge that, you know, Eccleston's character had, but he didn't. They just annihilated it and made him really kooky.
Yeah, but I think that's on the actors, isn't it? Because the BBC always afforded them the luxury of, you know, defining their character to some degree. So they, as an actor, they always want to distance themselves from the previous Doctor. So,
Well, let me ask you this. Going back to the first season, the series premiered with Rose, the first episode of the new series. I liked it. I liked the first episode. I liked the tone that it set. It was relatable in a sense because it didn't go full on batshit insane as the series would go on later. It was a little bit more toned down. It gave you a lot of meat with the character, especially in the scene where he's kind of face to face with that blob creature and they talk about his past and they don't really go full on, but you can tell there's something to it, which I really liked. And I didn't realize that the Autons were actually previous characters from the series. I thought they were just kind of
they're knocking back to Sean Pertwee days.
Yeah, which I kind of liked. And I liked the fact that they didn't go straight into one of the iconic characters. They used something a little bit more relatable, you know, the whole living plastic thing. The special effects were a bit iffy, but I kind of was like, okay, it's 2005, it's the BBC, I won't put too much effort into it. But I thought the first episode really set a great tone for what we can look forward to with the Doctor. Burhan, based on what you remember, what was your thoughts on the first episode?
On Eccleston, I loved it. I felt like it was something different. It was new. It was innovative. I just did not like Billy Piper's character. I felt Rose was just like a... To me, I knew who Billy was, and it reminded me a lot of the, do you have a boyfriend? Is he really cool?
She was too cutesy, in your opinion?
Not cutesy. I just don't think she knew what she was playing or how she was playing it. I think her character evolved over time, but then after she evolved over time, she then got more of a higher sense of herself, in a sense.
You know, there are. I've actually read articles where people put her as like the greatest sidekick of the Doctor, which we'll get to my pick for best sidekick when we get to the third series, in my opinion. But yeah, I like I said, I liked Rose up front. I kind of have a thing for that cute overbite. You know, I'm a sucker for that. But I will admit, as the series kept on, especially into series two, she started to grate on me. Dave, what was your thoughts on that first episode?
I loved it. If I can just slightly go on a tangent, it's related. I remember coming back from for vacation when I still live in Canada to this country, and I knew nothing about the fact that they were rebooting Doctor Who. And we have a talk show in this country, well, we did then, which was Jonathan Ross. And he had Chris Redfield.
Yeah, that was before he basically did the whole, like, thing.
Phone stalking someone, yeah.
Yes.
And basically Sachs. Saying...
Ooh, Jonathan yeah. Ross?
Yeah, yeah, he called him the bloke who played Manuel in Forty Towers.
And I said he wanted to fuck his daughter.
Yeah. And it's the reason he lost his job on BBC or his sitcom. Talk show. But before all that happened, I do remember coming back to the UK and I think it was the day before I flew back to Canada. And I just remember being amazingly surprised that on this talk show, they were talking about, like, so the reboot of Doctor Who's kicking in. And I was like, what? Being a big Doctor Who fan since I was a kid, like, wait, they're rebooting this series? It's not been on the air since 1989, ignoring the failed TV movie. And Jonathan Ross was talking about, like, so now you actually have a proper budget. You have, like, £2.5 million an episode, you know, to make this show. And they showed some clips, and I was just like, my jaw just hit the floor and just went, oh my God, this is absolutely amazing. And so, you know, I was on board. And then when I went back to Canada, one of my mates, quotation fingers, allegedly downloaded all the episodes off Torrent and burned them onto one disc for me and gave them to me, and I watched it. And I just, you know, the first episode, One of the standout scenes in the first episode, apart from the fact that it was clearly, you know, even though it wasn't a reboot, it was, you know, technically carrying on, so they had the Autons, was the bit where the Doctor pulls out the circuit board in his hand, where he's just disabled the bomb, and he just looks at Rose, and he just goes, run. And I was on board from that point. I was just like, oh my God, you just brought back my favorite childhood TV show in this. This is totally how I would do it if I had a budget. Because, you know, right, for English TV shows, you know, for North American TV shows, it may look a bit crap. But for English TV shows, the budget was so far beyond what it was, you know, obviously, for the UK TV shows from the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s.
Yeah, you were just happy that they weren't resorting to tinfoil and bubble wrap.
Yeah. And that's a true story, by the way. One of the monsters, I'll find a link and I'll send it to you later on, Miguel. One of the monsters in an episode of Doctor Who was basically bubble wrap wrapped around a person, sprayed green, and he pretended to be a maggot. No shit. But I was just like, oh my God, you brought it back and it's got decent special effects. This is brilliant.
Ooh, found it. Yeah, I found the picture. That is bubble wrap painted green.
Can you imagine the noise when he crawled across the studio floor? Pop, pop, pop.
It doesn't look bad, honestly. Like, I'm seeing clips where some of the actors are wearing the bubble wrap.
Oh, you gotta remember, though, the original Doctor Who scared the shit out of us as kids.
Yeah, there's the scene where the slime from the creature is on one of the characters, and it's just basically green bubble wrap, and it doesn't look too bad, honestly.
The original Cybermen are still my favorite Cybermen, by the way. All right, granted, they can't move their head left or right, but, you know, who wants to? It's like driving a car when you're elderly. Sorry, older people.
Speaking of other actors in that first season, let me just briefly bring
Simon Pegg's in it.
No, well, Simon Pegg, yeah,
who plays
but
that frosty person,
which was a nice get. I wish he'd have done more with his character, but I figure we might as well bring up Rose's parents because they do play a role in this series, unfortunately.
Oh, isn't she the bird from the John Goodman movie King Ralph? I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, she was.
Yeah, that's one of the few aspects of that first season that I was not a big fan of was the involvement of Rose's family, especially in Father's Day.
I didn't like the fact that she was always trying to flirt and bang the Doctor.
That was a give me at that point. Like, you knew that was the kind of joke that they would play up, unfortunately. But
yeah.
Like I said, just that whole episode, Father's Day, is just that to me shows why I'm not a big fan of the Rose character. There's so much selfishness.
Although Father's Day has the amazing cross time stream continuum problem, which is we both exist in our own time stream right now.
And it also brings up the whole aspect of fixed events, where there are certain events that you cannot rewrite or else, you know, bad shit happens.
Plus, I still don't really understand the ending where he gets... Sorry, people, spoilers. I know you say don't say that.
Oh, where he clones himself.
No, when he gets eaten by the big fucking flying pterodactyl, then all of a sudden he pops out at the end. Like, what? I don't get this.
Yeah, it's a very flimsy episode, but like I said, it reeks of...
The cross-time stream event, and like you said, a fixed event in time, that's a brilliant element.
Yeah, but just the whole aspect of Rose...
And the Doctor breaks his rules as well, which is, he went back once, but it's like, fine, we'll go back again. And he's a fucking Time Lord, so yeah. It's like, he knows the rules. He should not be doing that.
Well, he was mesmerized by the overbite. You know what can I say?
The thing is, as well, that gets to me about the whole like.
I think he just had the words because Tenet's relationship ringing in his head.
So. Oh my god, I'm gonna die! basically, the whole relationship between him and Piper's character annoyed the fuck out of me because it was like a schoolgirl crush. And then when they kind of found a way around it by humanizing the Doctor by having him clone himself. So he has like a 2-day-old version of himself.
Ah, but technically, even time stream things, it means even though it wouldn't be Tennant, it would be a half-formed Tennant. They could technically bring Tennant back again.
Yeah, but that's the thing. It's kind of opened the door for him to come back.
Does he do that in the fourth season where he clones himself, or have I not gotten to that point yet?
Haven't you seen that yet? Where his hand is up in the jar.
Fourth season, my bad. I don't mean to ruin that for you. Don't worry about it, Miguel. He doesn't technically clone himself. It gets really convoluted, and it ties into Torchwood.
Okay.
Yeah, it's kind of one of those situations where you think his character is going to end, right? And this is at the time they've never had.
Wait a minute. I do have to ask, does the hand come in play?
Yes.
Okay, then I think I know what you're talking about.
You might watch Torchwood before you watch the fourth season, and all I remember is it was such a big deal in this country that the local bookies, or the gambling shops were running odds, and they never do this. They normally just run odds on like football games and stuff like that. They were running odds on whether the Doctor would regenerate or not.
Well, you brought up Torchwood, and that brings up another aspect of the first season that I have to talk about, and that's John Barrowman as Captain Jack Harkness, who I'm officially going to say this right now. I'm not a gay man, but Jack Harkness technically is, because he'll fuck anything. If Jack Harkness was starting to hit on me, I might have to, because the man is...
John Barrowman is basically gay, right?
Yes, he is, but...
Oh, he is. He's got a man. No.
John Barrowman is actually Scottish, by the way.
Yeah, but the character of Jack Harkness is basically asexual. He'll have sex with anything, so
including a kitten.
Yes.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Ooh, and I own that kitten, and it took months and months of fucking psychotherapy.
But yeah,
he really torched its wood.
The man just oozes charisma. I mean, his involvement in, I argue, if it's one of my favorite episodes in the first season, because I like all of the episodes.
World War II ones.
Yeah, the Empty Child, like that.
Truly scary episode. But also when Billy Piper's hanging off the rope from up to the blimp that's supposed to stop shrapnel and stuff, and he just goes, nice bottom.
Was I the only one who wished that she would actually just fall to her death?
I had a feeling they weren't. I was sitting there going, they're not going to kill off the Doctor's companion this early in the series.
Please.
Like,
I was sitting there going, please.
We do have to also bring up Moffat. This is actually Moffat's debut episode. He's
the greatest writer, in my opinion.
Stephen Moffat wrote this episode. It wasn't written by James. And it's a great start, because I do think it's probably the strongest episode in both of them, The Empty Child and The Doctor Dances, because it's a two-parter. So much happens in this episode, and so much is built, and it's a dark episode, but it really does come together at the end. Like, it's...
Oh, with the bit when he goes, everybody lives.
Yeah, that whole scene, just how they played up on it. Even the end where you think Harkness is about to die, and then, spoiler alert, he gets saved by the Doctor and Rose.
And he has that brilliant scene where he asks his ship to prepare him a cocktail.
Oh, yeah, like, just the whole... John Barrowman just oozes charisma. I love him.
He does. Yeah.
Like.
Oh, wait for it. Wait till you see the first two seasons, at least, of...
Torchwood?
Torchwood. But he's got a greater role to play in Doctor Who. And when you get to Tennant's final episode, he has like a 30-second scene, but it's just so moving and absolutely great.
I hated that fucking last scene.
I love that scene.
Oh, that was bollocks. It was him being a fucking melodramatic fucking glimp.
Piss off. That was a great... That made Christmas 2009 for me.
Oh, God, that was so shitty. None of the other Doctors got that. They just fucking transformed. And he gets his little fucking farewell bullshit.
Well, he do a lot. I'll say why. And I brought up this point when I brought up Tennant before, which we'll get to in a bit because I'm going to wrap this up the first season. The thing about Tennant is he kind of became the de facto doctor for this new generation. I get why.
Geek chic is the phrase he invented.
Yeah. I get it. I get why people like the doctor because he
is my favorite doctor.
He's the most marketable of the doctors. He's the John Cena of Doctor Who doctors.
Suit, a long jacket, and Converse trainers. What's not to love about that?
He's got the most marketable personality. He's got the most marketable look. He's handsome for a doctor. I get why people latch on to
him. Even though he's Scottish, but we'll let him off.
Yeah, as the de facto doctor, I get why that's the case. Having said that, I still say the Ninth Doctor is better.
Here's the thing about Tennant and the thing Tennant versus Eccleston.
Whereas Eccleston, I think, elevated the Doctor Who material, Tennant is such a fanboy, he embraced it. He took what the Doctor was about in his mind and sharpened it to a fine edge. He was everything that people thought the Doctor
should be. He was marketable.
Yeah. You know, and he did not, and I get what Burhan is saying is that he didn't elevate the character like Eccleston did. He didn't bring anything different.
He was a very middle ground Doctor. He basically did the same thing that everyone else did with the character. And I like Tennant. I think Tennant is a good actor. I feel that he's done better.
Tennant is the plastic figure I have currently standing in my fucking TARDIS.
Well,
don't you dare say bad things about him.
Congratulations, Dave.
Yeah.
Right? The end of the day, right, he did nothing to make the Doctor stand out. The thing is, He was a long-lasting Doctor, but he did nothing to make the Doctor stand out.
Eccleston
was a better Doctor, in my opinion. And don't even get me started on fucking Matt Smith.
We're not going to get to Matt Smith because I haven't gotten that far. I've got one more season left. But
man, you're so jaded.
I'll say this.
Welcome to the future. It's Tennant.
Yeah. What I will say about the first season is it's my favorite season.
I only like it because it rhymes with your favorite beer.
Yeah. I like the first season more than the
beer.
Tennant.
No, it's not. Fuck off.
All right, boys.
If he was called Dr. Foster's, then, I'd blow your phone.
Anyway, as far as the first season, I liked the first season more than the other seasons because this one felt tight.
It had a big deal to make. It had to reestablish.
Yes, but at the same time, every episode in the season, with the exception of even the Unquiet Dead actually did tie in. Every episode in the season.
Oh, come on. Charles Dickens is fucking hilarious.
Well, no, that episode is great, but I was thinking about it and I'm like, yeah, they do go back to it. Every episode in that season is called back to in the greater good. There's an overarching storyline. Elements from every season every episode in the season play up later, whether it be elements from The Unquiet Dead, like the Rift that they talk about, characters from The End of the World that pop up later. The Slovene in the Aliens of London, which come back later.
That was a great episode.
Boomtown episode, I think it was. Even stuff from The Empty Child and The Doctor Dances, stuff from World War III. All of these episodes had elements that tie into it, whether you were paying attention or not. Even the stuff in The Long Game with the Satellite 5, that plays later in the season.
Well, that's what they're famous for. They did that back in the day.
Not in the next season, because the next season had a lot of filler episodes that I was just not a big fan of. It had a lot of just singular episodes, whereas, like I said, the first season, every episode called back later on in the season.
Don't mention the episode about chips, because I'm hungry.
Yeah, there were every episode.
I'd eat your Tennant doll.
Yeah, but you agree with me, Burhan, that every episode in the first season felt like it mattered. Like, there was no episode that didn't
And the finale is
they were reestablishing the character. They were reestablishing everything about the Doctor Who lore, and they updated it for a newer generation, and it worked.
And I still say it's a shame that Disney only brought back everything from the second season up, and they didn't bring anything from the first season. Because the first season's a little bit darker than the seasons after, but I do think fans deserve to see that first season.
Wait till you see Capaldi. Now we're on the second season. They get really dark.
But this is the thing with Capaldi's character again. They do something different. I like characters when you can define them and do something different. Tennant didn't do anything different from his predecessors. Yeah, he looked nice. He was a pretty boy.
Yeah, I disagree. I think Tennant was an absolute superb doctor.
I disagree with you on that one. I think he was good, but he wasn't amazing. Well, and let I me think ask, Eccleston let me... was a far superior doctor, in my opinion.
No, I'm not arguing that. I'm just saying I found something very agreeable with Tennant that, yes, I'm not going to marry him before you jump in with that, Burhan.
You got to marry him. Don't lie.
I think Tennant was a superb doctor. He was so charismatic. Anyway, let Miguel carry on so we can get to Tennant.
He wasn't charismatic, he was flirty. There's a difference.
I do have to ask, what was your guys' thoughts on the final episode, the two-parter Bad Wolf / Parting of the Ways?
Loved it. Absolutely adored it.
I did too. I really liked the way that played up. I liked the fact that this doctor was willing to basically commit genocide again.
And the speech he gives to the Uber Dalek in it is just... And you got that great scene when you actually get to see the TARDIS in space, and it's being chased by the missiles.
See, that's the thing. The difference between Tennant and Eccleston is Eccleston had those great monologues, and I don't really remember Tennant having lines like that there, where he delivered it with that kind of verve that Eccleston did. Like the scene where the Daleks are threatening to kill off Rose, and he just looks at him and goes, "No." It's like, what do you mean, no? It's like, no. And he's like, you have, I think the line is, you have no weapons, no defenses, no plan. And he just looks at him and he goes, yep. And that scares you to death, doesn't it? And he tells how he's going to save Rose. And there's so many great lines in that episode. It's hard to tell, folks.
That's the great thing about the Doctor. The Doctor's not a action fucking character, right? The Doctor is someone who...
He's technically a pacifist, if you think about
it. He comes in with... No, but that depends on the iteration of the Doctor.
Well, no, what I'm saying is he only raises his hand if you absolutely force him to.
Yeah, but he always comes up with a plan, and this is one of the reasons why I love the newest incarnation of the Doctor, because he doesn't know who he is. He's finding himself again. Mm. Whereas with Eccleston's character, he came in sure of who he was, you know? Which was great. He was like... Yeah, I know who the fuck I am.
Yeah, but isn't that even to be explained by the reintroduction of a franchise that was beloved by everyone that you needed to...
But it wasn't just that. You knew there was a story behind it, but you didn't know exactly who he was yet. And that's the great thing about it. And that's the one thing that when you came up with Tennant's character, it was already established. He was there. But he was basically playing homage.
I love you, David Tennant. Don't listen to him. He's just got sand in his vagina.
Calm down.
You know what? He's... You know the new series that he's in on ITV?
No.
That Tennant's in? They're currently bringing it to America. Trying to figure out what it was called again.
I know the one you mean. They've already brought it to America.
Yeah, apparently his American accent is terrible, but...
Where he's the fucking detective and shit.
Isn't he going to be in Jessica Jones, that new series, that new Marvel series?
He's playing
series?
The villain in that, I believe.
He was brilliant and frightening.
He's playing,
I have to say that.
Apparently there's rumors that he's playing the Purple Man.
Hmm. Wait, so, Five Nights at Freddy's purple guy?
No.
That would be kind of funny. I'd be like, I'd watch that.
The guy who basically rapes Jessica Jones's mind to the point where he... forces her to watch him rape women and begs him to take her. He's so manipulative, but I don't know how they're going to play it out in this, so I can't wait to see what's going on.
Help me out here. What was the show he did for ITV that got exported to America? Him with the bird who was in the...
I do see there's a Grace Point is a U.S. remake of a series called Broadchurch.
That's it, yes.
Okay, so it is Grace Point. It was a remake.
Yeah, it's no, it's not a remake. It's kind of a reimagining because War Touch is still going on.
That was on Fox. Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, apparently
was it well received?
No. It only lasted one season on Fox, so
people hated it.
Let me see here. Wait, no, it says here the series received positive reviews from critics, though not without unfavorable comparisons to the original UK series. Let's see, Rotten Tomatoes, it's sitting at a 66%. Based on 58 reviews, so it's
people
about
hated his accent as well. They didn't think it worked.
I'll have to look into that actually.
Shame really, yeah. Because if you ever hear him speak in his actual tongue, it's quite surprising. And I would have. And the irony is with the current Doctor, he speaks with a Scottish tongue, and the last time we had a Scottish Doctor, he spoke with an English tongue. So
yeah. But saying that, as I said, going on from him, I felt that he's kind of the middle ground guy. He's the guy that does, that does a lot of fan service, but also does a lot to appease the guys in the, you know, in the main kind of producers and stuff.
He's a big
that.
Convention guy, though. I will
he
say
is,
this, which I do appreciate.
David Tennant is one of those where I felt he did an okay job as a Doctor, but he's given a hell of a lot more credit than his predecessor.
See, we'll have to agree to disagree
because
I love Tennant. It's my favourite Doctor.
That's because Eccleston bowed out early, in my opinion. Right? But saying that, I think Tennant is still a lot better than Matt Smith, who I felt was terrible.
Well, you know, when we bring back the series, we'll definitely revisit Who so we can talk about the rest of it. But
well,
I will say,
as I said, you could always do the Doctor Who vlogs and basically do like a series by series breakdown, maybe once a little bit.
Oh, we
like,
could do something else where we review every episode of Doctor Who each week.
That would be a big endeavor, but I want to talk about season two now because my biggest problem that I have with season two, not Tennant because I thought he did fine in it, but my biggest problem with season two is there were a lot more filler episodes, and I realized this going back and rewatching it.
They kind of went all anime with those fucking filler episodes, didn't they?
Not so much. It's just that I felt that a lot of these episodes kind of were hit and miss. Stuff like School Reunion, I loved. I loved seeing Anthony Head against the Doctor. Just seeing them talk to each other was just acting in the making, in my opinion. And I liked the fact that it was a throwback and it reintroduced Sarah Jane Smith.
Yeah, they reconnected the fact that this franchise is not separate from the original franchise. Mm-hmm.
I did like that. I did like that, and I really appreciated that. Girl in the Fireplace is another Moffat, and I thought Tennant was really good. I think that one is where he really showed his acting chops, in my opinion, in that one. He had a lot of good moments in that episode. But then you have stuff like my least favorite episode so far, and I've told Dave and you about that, Love and Monsters, which is one of the few episodes where any episode, with the exception of one specific one where it doesn't focus on the Doctor, to me fails, and this one fails spectacularly. This is an awful episode.
We'll get to season three, and there's an amazing episode.
We'll get to that. I know which episode you're talking about that doesn't have the Doctor, but we'll get to that. But Love and Monsters, that was the one with the big green creature where they focus on the fan club, essentially, for the Doctor.
Oh, was that the Northern bloke, the stand-up comic?
It may have been.
When he absorbs them into his body.
You mean what would happen if Fat Bastard was an alien? Yeah.
That fat dude. I forgot what his name is. Everyone likes him. I think he's shit. What's his name?
I like him.
Peter Kay.
But it has that really creepy moment at the end where the Doctor saves her face. Again, people, sorry, spoilers. In the slab of the pavement. And he goes, and it's a kids show, technically. Regardless of the fact that it's scary, it's a kid's show, and he actually says to the camera, we have a sex life of sorts. And I'm like, it's a face in a... Oh, my God, your face in a slab blows you, doesn't it? That's just wrong. You should.
That whole episode was awful and then got really dark towards the end, where it kind of... where the Doctor comes back and they tell the guy why his...
He was in Band of Brothers, by the way. He was Blythe, who got blinded.
Yeah, the way that they tied that character in with the Doctor was kind of dark. And like I said, any episode where it doesn't focus mainly on the Doctor fails, except for one specific episode that we'll get to. But that one was awful. You had episodes like Fear Her, which I thought was kind of lame. It was basically just there to promote the 2012 games.
Do you know why they did that episode and why they did
to
the
promote
same
the
one,
2012 games?
No, it was actually because they were so busy filming other episodes that they needed an actual breather, so they asked the writers to write an episode where the main characters would only be in it briefly.
Oh. Well, then you had, well, like I said, it doesn't help that the episode's just lame. You had stuff like The Idiot Lantern, which was a lame episode. There were so many episodes that just felt flat to me, and I was just not a fan of this season.
The werewolf episode was brilliant, though.
Tooth and Claw, which actually, I realized something with Tooth and Claw, and I didn't realize this was a theme for Doctor Who, that the third episode in every series is a period piece episode. I had to think back. The one with Charles Dickens.
I love the bit when Queen Victoria, you know, looks at Billy Piper and basically just says, you know, even though she's dressed by our standards, and just go like, basically she says like, oh my God, you look naked.
But yeah, every episode's a period piece, because I thought about it. I'm like, wait a minute. The Charles Dickens episode was the third episode. Tooth and Claw's the third episode. Shakespeare's Code is the third episode. And then they have the one that's coming up where Donna and the Doctor visit Rome, which is a period piece. So That's a great episode. I haven't gotten to it yet. But yeah, as far as the second season, I'm not a big fan of. I will say, though, Army of Ghosts and Doomsday is my favorite ending so far. I think it's better than Parting of the Ways. I loved that whole two-parter. Just the scope of just how big the danger was and the fact that the Doctor was still able to not only fix the issue but make it work, which we'll get to in the third season, which I was not a fan of that ending. But I thought that that whole thing was working. And I thought it was a nice way that they wrote out the Rose Tyler storyline, how they tied up her character.
Oh, it's really moving. No, it's actually, I will say this, you know, it's a really good moving ending. I really liked it.
Yeah, and I will admit, I did kind of smile a little bit when the future dimension Mr. Tyler met up with the current day Mrs. Tyler. That was a nice little moment. I thought that it was kind of nice that they tied up that loose end. But yeah, just like I said, there's a lot of good about the second season, but there's a lot of fluff that I could do without. Dave, you love Tennant, so I'm assuming you love the second season.
It's not. I'm with you, and I'm with Burhan. It's not without its flaws, but I really enjoy the second season. I really enjoy David Tennant as a Doctor. I just think, you know, he made it more. It was. See, I understand what Burhan's saying, and I love Eggleston being hard-edged and, you know, kind of like, I'll save your planet, but only because I have to. But I like the fact that, you know, Tennant took it in a different direction, which is, I can't just do that. I can't repeat that, because what's the point? So he made it this more kind of, you know, forgiving Doctor. But that's not to say that there aren't episodes and you haven't got to them yet. You may have got to one when you don't see Tennant being an absolute badass, when he can just go, well, because I'm a nice guy doesn't mean I can't be a Time Lord and honor my fucking tradition. I think you know what episode that is. But
yeah, and I wasn't a big fan of the way they portrayed him in that one, but we'll get to that. Burhan, what's your thoughts on the second season?
I didn't like it. To tell you the truth, I felt like it just didn't work for me. I felt they concentrated a lot more on cameos and separate kind of non-linear stories than actually trying to concentrate on what the hell was going on. I felt Tennant's role was kind of being reduced, and they tend to focus a hell of a lot more on
his
relationship.
You can agree with this,
can't
you? Which is, he's clearly the best dressed Doctor.
I liked his character. I liked the way he was dressed, and I liked him. I just felt he wasn't as great as Eccleston, and I felt that he kind of went more fanboyish, kind of, to the previous Doctors.
Well, I think they were riding the success of the show,
creating his own. But it's not just that. I felt he didn't create his own identity. I could see a lot of all the old Doctors in him, but I couldn't see his own character stand out. But that being said, when you watch his final season, you actually see a lot more of him come out of the character a bit more. So you get to see a lot more character progression. But I just felt that he did nothing new with a character that, at least with Eccleston, he experimented with.
I do also have to bring up the second season did bring up the concept of the Christmas episode, which was how they actually introduced David Tennant, which is something we'll get into in a bit.
Well, is that technically the end of the first season?
No, they technically consider the Christmas episodes are technically considered the first episodes of the new season. They're in with the box set of their seasons. Like Christmas Invasion is boxed with series two. The Runaway Bride is with series three, so on and so forth.
By the way, the Tennant Christmas, the Christmas Invasion, I have a big problem with that, which is you've just introduced the new Doctor, and we don't get to see fuck all of him until the last 15 minutes.
It goes back to what I said, when you have episodes that focus less on the Doctor and more on the rest of the side characters, a lot of times it doesn't work, and that was an episode that didn't work. But it pulled together when they actually did introduce, when he did have his big coming out moment.
Although, sorry people, spoilers, it introduced the Hand.
Yes, and which we'll be playing in later. And it does introduce Torchwood. This was actually the first moment that we actually did hear about Torchwood being brought up. Which, for those of you that don't know, Torchwood is basically like the British Men in Black. It's their alien-based organization where they basically co-opt whatever the Doctor runs into and kind of just tries to make it its own thing in a way. I know there's more to it than that, but based on what I've seen so far, that's essentially what it has become. But yeah, I do want to touch on the first episode of the third season, Runaway Bride, because this worried me. I will say, having seen...
But you have to take Christmas episodes slightly with a pinch of salt outside of the mainstream, even though they are canon, outside of the mainstream of regular episodes, if that makes sense, because they're that big event that they do every Christmas Day in this country to get loads and loads of viewers.
Here's why I debate you on that, because the Runaway Bride does introduce the character of Donna, which she becomes the companion in the fourth season, and her...
And also the fact is, I consider her more of a diverse
annoying
character.
Cow?
No, I feel she's more diverse in comparison to Billy Piper's character, who I consider the real annoying cow.
See, the Runaway Bride did a terrible job of introducing me to Donna. I thought she was unbearable.
I agree on that one.
She is in this country, don't you?
She's a comedian. You've said it before. Like, she has like a weird comedic. That's basically her shtick, is being kind of bratty
abrasive
and annoying. But she does redeem herself in Partners in Crime. She does kind of they give her more story content, and they flesh her character out.
I get confused with seasons. I don't know. You got the amazing season where she gets thrusted back and forth through a timeline because she's got like a time sponging beetle on her back.
I think that might be season four. I haven't finished it yet. Is it the brilliant episode? Yeah, but this season does do one good thing: is it introduces who I think is my favorite companion of the entire series, and that's Martha Jones.
She's my favorite companion. I have to say, she's my favorite.
Yeah,
companion.
And I'm gonna call her Martha Jones because I still haven't figured out how to pronounce her name.
Frigga or Freema? Frigga Egerman.
They so badly wrote her character, though.
Yeah,
so good.
She was good because, unlike Piper, she actually, you bought her.
She had chops.
Yeah, you bought her as
she
a character.
Questioned.
By the way, her name is Freema Abadero.
What the fuck did you just say? Like, you were so congested. Like,
I'm sorry. I'm Freema, sorry.
Freema.
Can I
Freema,
tell my my
Freema F R E M A Freema F R E M A Abadero.
Ah, okay. But yeah, I'm
just saying.
I have a love-hate relationship with her story arc because, as a character, I love her. I think she is smart. I think she really is able to keep up with the Doctor, whereas Rose just kind
she's
of enabled the Doctor.
Yeah, Rose was very much a puppy in love, but Freema was a counter to everything the Doctor said.
And you mentioned the love thing, and that's really my biggest beef with this season, is that they layer on the fact that Martha is in love with the Doctor, but the Doctor does not see anything in her too much for me. Like, they made it too... They made it too much of the aspect of
it. What they did was they figured everyone loved what we did with Billy Piper, so we'd just repeat it and then ramp it up a little bit with this bird.
But here's the thing, they didn't reciprocate. Like, they made it very clear every chance they had that there was nothing going on with the Doctor. and Martha Jones. Whereas in the first season, yeah, there was a relationship there between the Ninth Doctor and
she'll
Rose
be back.
I know who she ends up with, which I think is a cop out, but I don't know. I think the Ninth Doctor and her as his companion would be my perfect team so far. I think they would have really worked together. But
and
yeah,
let's not forget the fact that she was really hot.
Yeah, she was. I think that actress is beautiful. Like, pretty I like Billie Piper, but that actress that played her is really stunning. And the first black companion for the Doctor. Yes. Am I right?
Which was a really big deal in this country, but most of the people in this country just went, we've moved beyond this. We don't care.
Yeah, can you imagine could you imagine if this had happened in the U.S., like a franchise decided to do that? Oh, wait, we don't have to. We just talked like 20 minutes about fucking Star Wars.
Yep.
If they'd have done this over here in the States, there'd have been like, you know, cancel BBC or something like that. Some bullshit Twitter thingy. Like, I'm just...
This is the thing that bugs me about it is she was every bit as good as Piper's character, yet they decided, let's write about the fact that his whole lot so hung up on Rose.
Oh, yeah.
And she only got one season. That really annoyed me.
Yeah, because she just... I think she got tired of it.
But she was so lonely.
Yeah,
but
they
run her into a corner. That was the problem. They didn't do anything with her. You know,
that's not entirely true. She was a really strong character at the start.
She was
strong,
but the problem was they kind of just didn't do anything with it. They didn't do anything to kind of build her up and make her the Doctor's equal. They just went, meh.
Mm. Yeah, I made a comment in the Anime Comics Movies and Games Forum. Like, she is the definition of friend-zoned. And everybody was kind of like, yeah, no one argued against it. They were just like, yeah, that's bad. And it's unfortunate because I think she deserved a lot more. I know that she pops up in Torchwood. I'm looking forward to seeing what she does in there. I know who
she does return. Like I said, she does return.
Yeah. As far as season three, I will say the episodes here were a lot tighter. They weren't nearly as tight as the first season.
That's my favorite season.
But I do like a lot of the episodes here. I think a lot of the filler episodes work for me. Like, I love the Shakespeare's Code, Gridlock, Daleks in Manhattan.
Blake.
All of those were great. Oh, well, let's go to the award-winning one, the one that everybody talks about. This one actually caught me by surprise because I mentioned before there's the episode that I wasn't a big fan of was the two-parter, Human Nature and the Family of Blood, and that was before Blink, so I was kind of like, ugh, you just did a two-part episode where the Doctor wasn't the Doctor, and you're going to follow
really
it up with...
I really did like The Family of Blood. Can I just give you a little bit of backstory on that?
Go ahead.
That was actually based on a novel written in the 80s based around the Sylvester McCoy Doctor.
Mm.
So it's not an entirely new thing. It was a novel that, you know, basically did, it treaded the same ground as, the Family of Blood episode, and you know, the Doctor put his life force in a watch so he could hide away from it. But I love that episode for two reasons. One, we get to see Tennant being absolutely badass. Two, we get to see him being very vulnerable when he's reverted to human form. But when he's in badass mode, I love it. And see, especially the end when he traps a person in the supernova, he traps the girl in the mirror, he makes the person into a scarecrow to watch the lands of England, you know, for the rest of his life. I adore that episode.
I actually hated that at last part because they built up what he did, but they don't show us. It's kind of like, oh, he does all this stuff off screen. And I'm just like, well, thanks, episode.
But that's the best way to build it, because I like the fact that they set up, which is, you know, it turns out the Doctor wasn't hiding from them, you know, to protect himself. He was hiding from them to protect them. And I really like that bad element. And to me, that was like, finally, at least in Tennant's, era of the Doctor, we got to realize that if his hand was forced, he could be an absolute badass nightmare.
I think if it had been better portrayed in other episodes before, it probably would have had more weight. But like Burhan said, up until this point, he had been kind of foppish through most of the series. So
I think,
you know,
he was leaning on there was that element in his character, though.
The only time I remember him showing any sort of intensity was in the Idiot Box, or the one with the possessed TV. There was a couple flashes of that, but I did not buy it in this one. But however,
I just love it. It's one of my favorite episodes. Not up there with Blink, but I just like the fact that if you force the Doctor's hand, he can be an absolute asshole. And it's something that ties back to me as a kid when I was scared of looking in mirrors, which is, you know, he trapped her in a mirror. Every mirror, every time you see that person behind you peering through a doorway, that's her. She's in every mirror.
Don't you sleep in front of a mirror, by the way?
No, I got rid of it because this shit like this scares me.
Yeah, you were afraid of the person staring back at you.
Yeah. Mainly me.
Yeah.
And now that I'm 40, I look at me and just go like, oh, fuck, what do I turn into? But no, I really like the fact that they flipped it and finally, like, you know, because it was under the surface that Tennant was, you know, possibly bubbling to be, if his hand was forced to be that asshole. And I just love that episode, you know. You know, he chained my mother and he kicked her into a supernova and stuff like that. Or a collapsing star. I love that episode so much, especially the bit when he's clumsy and he, you know, walks into the alien's ship when he's got his soul back and he pretends to be the person who doesn't have it and he falls over and he knocks all their, you know, schematics and controls down. And then he puts his glasses on and he goes like, oh, if I was you, I'd be more worried about my thermal reactor about to blow up.
See, here's another issue that I had with it. I hated the villains in that episode because they all seemed to come from the Jim Carrey school of acting, where it was all
face.
Come
on, shooting the scarecrows with World War guns was scary.
That scene where it was all in slow motion was well done, but those villains, the main three villains, were just so goofy. They were such a turnoff, and I was just like, oh, God, just stop it. It's not Jim Carrey with that Play-Doh face thing. Ugh. I hated that episode because of that.
I love that episode. Well, you know, each to their own. And I'm not going to judge you on it, but I'd like to say I love those two episodes. I really do. But that might be because also I have, you know, having read that book at school as a child when I was 12, because that's how old the story is. I have a certain amount of nostalgia attached to the story, if that makes sense.
Well, going back to the episode that follows it, I get why people think Blink is one of the best episodes. I do.
I adore that episode.
I like the fact that
the
Weeping Angels are a cool aspect of it, and they do come back later on, right? They do make it.
I have a figure. I'll take a picture and send it to you later on. I have a figure of a Weeping Angel. I'll put it next to my TARDIS because he's got opposable hands. So
yeah, but yeah, I will say this did kind of break my mentality of an episode without the Doctor can't be good without him. This one, the Doctor really doesn't play a role. It focuses on a different character, but
that really hot chick from the video store.
Yeah, but at the same time, it works so well, and every aspect of it is so well crafted.
The Easter eggs.
Yeah, the pictures, the conversation. Everything about that episode works so well.
She rips the wallpaper off at the start.
Yeah, the wallpaper. Yeah, that
and
too.
And then it goes duck.
No, seriously, duck. Yeah. No, you. And then it says her name. It's like, duck now.
And it's got that brilliant sequence, which is the Weeping Angels, which is for one time, you know, Doctor Who, it's just the Weeping Angels are the nicest killers in the galaxy because they don't kill you. They move you to another time, then suck your life force away from the time that you were in.
Which is horrifying if you think about it.
Well, yeah, but they don't kill you, which is unknown.
At the same time, they drop you into a foreign time period. Like,
but you got that amazing letter that she receives from a friend.
Anyway, she receives a letter, yeah.
I adore that episode. I'm not going to lie. Every time I walk by statues and graveyards, especially today when I went to a funeral, I always look twice, and I've never taken them in the same vein since, which is, you're not, are you? No, you're not. This is real life. Yeah, but you might be. And
this was the episode. This was the episode that made me realize why Moffat took over once Russell T. Davies left. Like, I get it after seeing this episode.
It's a very moving scene that almost moved me to tears.
Which one? Was it the hospital scene?
Yeah, the police officer.
Yeah, it's a great episode. Like, there's a lot of good performances.
And then you got that amazing ending as well.
Yeah, I just want to point out, Sean just had to leave. You know, he just kind of wanted to listen on the side. But we do appreciate you for being on, buddy. Thanks for joining in. And he wished you a happy birthday, by the way, Dave.
Thanks, Sean.
But yeah, I thought this was a great episode.
But the ending is brilliant because it ties into that whole kind of, you know, time.
It wraps around itself.
Yeah, it's not necessarily relevant. And isn't this the episode where they introduced the phrase timey-wimey lines?
Yes, a phrase that I think pop culture has kind of hijacked in a way. I mean, we started our episode with it, so that tells you what that's about. Burhan, you've been a little bit quiet. Well, not so much quiet, you've been coughing, but what was your thoughts on Blink?
Oh, well, it basically added a different dimension to Doctor as well. Basically added, I can't really freaking talk. It added more of a darker layer and it showed what they could actually do with the character if they actually, like, you know, put something together. Usually, it's like for the first season, they kind of went into a whole different spin. It was dark, but it wasn't like they didn't kind of pull the strings. Then once they progressed, the episode started getting darker and darker, and they could show some evil fucking shit that they could do.
The bit when they're outside of the building. Oh, that still terrifies me.
I think that has to do with Moffat. Moffat has kind of gotten this reputation about being a writer who could go dark and who isn't afraid to kill off a character if he has to. And I think that's why you saw a lot more of that when he took over during Matt Smith's season.
Plus, it has one of the greatest endings, which is the ending where you think you suddenly realize that the Doctor is a genius. Do you think he's abandoned these people? But he's saving them, and he does it by basically sleight of hand.
Yeah. I will say that, yeah, Blink was a great episode, and I'll be honest, the three episodes after do not live up to it. This brings
us... You got two more episodes. Sorry, people. Spoilers.
Three.
It's with the... three. With the
Utopia, The Sound of Drums, and The Last of the Time Lords, which essentially starts the Master
Studio. Oh, no, I meant you got two more episodes with... well, actually, three, technically, if you count the Christmas special with the Weeping Angels.
Yeah. But yeah, this goes into the master story arc from Utopia, Sound of Drums, and Last of the Time Lords. I have a problem with the story arc, and I'll say why. Up until this point, the Doctor established something. The established mindset of the Doctor was, no matter how bad things get, you know he's going to figure out a way to solve it, and you know it's going to make sense. The Doomsday story arc, for instance, that made sense the way that they ended it.
That ramps up the last episode we talked about, which is you had no idea how it was going to out of that one, even though he wasn't technically in it, but he did it. So that's what you expect from the Doctor, which is he's supposed to be the most intelligent person on the planet, even though it's an alien, but he always has a way out.
Yeah, and I thought that the build-up during the Master story arc was great. I thought, what's his name? What was the actor that played the Master? John Sims. No, I was going to say John Sims.
The old bloke before he became John Sims.
The old man was good. I liked how he played that. His heel turn was abrupt, but it made sense for the time that he was on.
I just like the way he said John Sims, you went heel turn. I was getting ready to say a John Cena comment there.
Yeah, Barrowman came back, and also they kind of referenced the hand again.
Yeah, which I know now what you guys are talking about before, but... I like the buildup in the Master story arc where it kind of, you really did look at it like, wow, how's the Doctor going to get out of this? Like, basically.
And they also did something with the Master that's never been done before. They gave him a character. They gave him a written narrative. They gave him a backstory. You actually started to understand why he was the Doctor's polar opposite. You know, like you have the Batman and the Joker. You have these like polar opposite characters who are like Superman and Lex Luthor, you know, for instance, where Superman's the powerful guy, so Lex
he just wasn't the
guy.
Evil bastard in the corner.
No, he wasn't. He was someone who basically went through his own different life and his own different things and wanted different things than the other guy, you know? But he basically did some evil stuff in order to... like get his plans
but it was
also found as well
because you know he was shaped by how he grew up in, you know, Gallifrey and stuff like that, so while he was evil, it wasn't necessarily his fault, it was just the path he was determined to be put on.
He went insane basically when I think the story is of his is he went insane when he looked at that time vortex thing. But like I said, I like the build up because they really do. He gets away with a lot. Like the whole story of him basically essentially taking over the world.
He kicks the doctor's ass. Let's
yeah,
not forget.
He traps the he makes the doctor old. He traps him. He basically wins for all intents and purposes. And then, as I've told Dave before, when we briefly talked about it in one of the episodes, there was the ending, which is basically, like I said, every other episode seemed to make sense within the universe of the Doctor. This one was an ass pull. I don't care
That whispering shit.
Yeah, essentially, for those of you that don't know, we're gonna spoil it for you, and we're gonna do you a favor because this is terrible. Basically, the way the Doctor is saved is Martha tells people, everybody in the world, to think of the Doctor at one specific moment, and somehow it regenerates the Doctor, and he's not old anymore. And by this point, not only is he old, he's like a midget. He's had so much of his life force
he's
taken out.
He's a bird in a cage at this point.
Yeah, he's like this tiny, big-headed, like alien creature. And then the moment happens, and everybody thinks of the word the Doctor, and somehow the Doctor regenerates, and he becomes this, you know, super god, and he's able to take down the Master. And I'm just sitting there, and I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? This is worse than Disney in terms of just MacGuffin. This is... What was the word that you used to describe it, Dave?
Bollocks?
Yes, that's the word. Yes, that it is very much so.
Because they actually set it up on a premise that it's quite good, because the initial start of the Whispering, I thought was like to build a rebellion, if that makes sense. To build like a resistance. And you got these drones coming in and trying to fight them and shit like that. And you're like, oh, this is going somewhere. And then it's like, no, apparently we just say we love the Doctor. We got word for the Doctor. And that's enough to regenerate him.
Yeah, and I know they try to justify it by saying that he somehow tapped into the network that the Master had set up on the cell phone, which how? I don't know.
I know this, by the way. The screwdriver that the Master had, the laser screwdriver.
Yes.
Which is discontinued now. If you bought that and it's still sealed, it's worth a fucking fortune because it only was released for 6 months.
Wow.
Yeah. But you know as well though. The reason why they did it that way is because he wrote himself into a corner.
Yeah, I can tell that they had no out.
But the greatest thing about that episode, actually no, that's the wrong episode. I'll just say this, Miguel. I'll just say this: you've got a fucking treat coming your way, and all I will say is redemption.
I'll have to look into that because I hated, and I was looking forward to the Master story arc because I knew how much the Master meant to the Doctor Who universe, so I was kind of looking forward to it, like, oh, we're gonna get into this big story arc that, you know, was a big deal in the other seasons.
Wait till you see until he dyes his hair.
I know that the new Master, or Mistress as it is, I am looking forward to seeing how they play off that character, because that is an interesting twist on it. But yeah, series 3, aside from the ending, I thought was a stronger season than season 2. I thought there were too many gaps in season 2. This one was a lot tighter. If this season had the ending that the second season had, I would honestly put it higher than the first season because I think Doomsday is a great ending. I thought the rest of the season, though, was crap. I thought this season was good, but the ending was crap. If you could take the ending from 2 with the bulk of 3 and meld it together, I think it would have been a better season than the first season, in all honesty. I think you would have had a really good, solid follow-up to that first season, but it is what it is. I think
it's technically considered in Doctor Who folklore right now as a parallel timeline.
Really? Is it because of the face of Bo comment, which I thought was kind of funny that they make
basically it's, you know, what's his name?
Jack Harkness. I did like that little line at the end. I thought that was kind of cute, which is funny because when you think about it, if you think of how Miracle Day ended, which I do know how that ended because I read ahead of that, it kind of negates the ending.
That was the whole Torchwood American spinoff thing. They were going to make it more, but it just didn't get the viewership that they wanted.
Same thing happened with Sarah Jane Chronicles. When they brought it, when Sci-Fi brought it over, it tanked
ratings-wise. I have to say this. Sadly, the actress died, didn't she?
Who, Sarah Jane?
Yeah.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
Yeah, that's why they never made any more episodes. I think they released the final season was only like about 6 episodes, I believe.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Well, but yeah, it's one of those things. I think with the third season, you could tell that they were coming into their own, that the characters were starting to take a lot more shape, and they were writing a lot more interesting stories with, you know, apart from the whole writing.
You know, a really sad thing about this conversation we're having right now on Skype is, before I go to bed, I'm gonna have to watch Blink.
Well, we're about to wrap things up. I will say I'm only two episodes into the new fourth series. So I've seen Village of the Damned and Partners in Crime. Village of the Damned.
Is that Tenet's last season? Isn't
yes.
It?
Yeah, because after that is the specials quotation.
Yeah, because he basically does the Christmas specials because he's like, I'm not coming back.
In his defense, Burhan, it wasn't that he wasn't coming back. He was committed to Broadway. So
wasn't to Broadway. He was committed to basically doing Shakespeare. Because he was doing
but
a
the
lot
point
of
is he was committed to you know stage plays so you know in his defense fair play he returned
well his asking price went fucking shit high after he did The Doctor so I can understand why for like doing some theater performances you get paid a hell of a lot of money than he would to bounce around and be a Time Lord so
and they are really good by the way Miguel they are really good the specials well at least three of them the two-parter no spoilers I'm not going to even say it the two-parter cough thingy at the end and one of the episodes in the middle the Ghost of Mars are absolutely fantastic
I'll have to look I'm definitely going to keep
looking and their feature-length episode well feature-length in this country is an hour
I will say this Voyage of the Damned was a good you know little side episode it didn't have the same verve that the other Christmas episodes had but it was nice I did dislike.
He returns, by the way. Do you know when he goes back to Earth and no one else is around, and he takes Kylie Minogue down to the planet with him, and there's that bloke in the newspaper stand.
Yeah.
He returns.
Okay.
And he becomes a really prevalent and good character.
But that you mentioned Kylie Minogue, and that annoyed me because I had just finished seeing.
I liked her in this.
I hate her.
She was fine into this. What bothered me about it was you just ended the third season having the Doctor's companion walk away because you were too attached to the previous companion. You were madly in love.
You go for a spell right now, by the way. You do go for a spell where there are no companions for quite a long time.
But they
are committed to the fact that, you know, He doesn't want to, and he openly says it, he doesn't want to travel with companions anymore because he doesn't want to feel their loss, which is a nice little touch for, you know, acting skills.
Yeah, I they just ended Last of the Time Lords with Martha walking away because of the fact that he was too wound up with Rose. And then you have a whole episode where he falls madly in love with this cocktail waitress. And as a fan of Martha Jones...
Fucking Kylie Minogue! Why wouldn't you fall in massively in love with her?
But it makes
no fucking sense. Again, right, this is the thing, and this is one of the things that pisses me off, right? When it comes
Johnny, bird in the universe, I'll tip twice.
Yeah, but Dave, there's in a story, you set up a story, you set up a universe. Things have to be relevant in terms of that universe. Nick would understand when it comes... Nick would understand when it comes into terms of professional wrestling. Do you know what I mean, Nick? There are rules that you must follow.
Yep.
In the fucking Doctorverse, the rules that you follow here is he's in love with fucking Rose, and then you get this other woman that entices him after you have this whole fucking Barbie with his sister walking away. No, but do you know what I mean? It makes no fucking sense. You've just destroyed all this backstory. But then suddenly when she leaves, when the history runs its course with this woman, back to Rose again.
Yeah, I just... It went against the Doctor's better nature. And the only reason I don't... The only reason I'm not as mad about it is because it is a Christmas episode. So, you can argue how much of it...
Continuity, by the way. You know that, right?
I know the Christmas episodes are still within continuity, but there are people that argue about some people argue they're canon.
You know what they get Christmas Day in this country? It's an institution.
Yeah, I know.
You get like 60 million views.
Oh, no. Oh, yeah. I'm the Voyage of the Damned. I'm looking at the viewership. There were 13 million people watching that episode, which is huge. For a small island like that, yeah, that's a lot of people, but... I will say Partners in Crime was a good start. I did like the fact that they played up the whole episode to where they were constantly crossing paths. And
when we cross into your new format for this show, we have to do a follow up to this, because I could talk Doctor Who all day long, and there's so much good shit coming your way that you have not seen, mate. You have no idea.
I might have to fire up Fires of Pompeii after this episode when we finish. I'll fire up that episode on Hulu, but I like Partners in Crime. I like the fact that they kind of built up the tension between them as far as when they'll finally, you know, meet. And they do. And I like the little exchange between them from across the room where they're kind of just pantomiming. And then all of a sudden when they're finally found out, I thought that was funny, where the space nanny just looks at them and goes, no, did we interrupt you? Like, I love that little bit. But yeah, I did think that they really did introduce Donna in a better life. Light. English, ladies and gentlemen.
English.
Yeah, English. They did introduce
English,
her in a better...
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
You take plug and you plug it into back off electrical device. And then it work. Press
What's
on
that?
Button.
You want one, Tatsu? I'll feed that a free button.
Shut up. Don't make fun of my English. But yeah, I did like the scenes that they had with her and her dad. They were better parent scenes than anything we got with Rose and Jackie, I'll say that. But I like the fact that they made her a more sympathetic character. They gave her this kind of softer look to her than the abrasive character that she had in Runaway Bride. So I'm looking forward to her in this season. And I am looking forward to the fourth season.
She's not terrible. I'll say that. She's not terrible. She's not my cup of tea for, you know, an assistant, but she's not terrible.
I right off the bat, I don't think she'll be better than Martha. I'm such a big fan of Martha.
No one can be better than Martha, because she's lovely and wonderful. Martha, come and have a beer with me.
She seems so nice. But yeah, speaking of what's...
I will say this, by the way, and no spoilers, I'm just going to say this. When you watch, Pompeii episode, that's the one episode they bring up the, you know, importance of not interfering with the timeline more so, even though it's a throwaway episode because it's like the first episode. But it's the one episode they really drum up the importance of not fucking with the timeline, even though you may think, well, hang on, this is terrible. We should stop this. You can. It's the timeline. Yeah, this
fixed
is
timeline.
Already. Yeah, it's already happened. You know, we have no place to stop it.
And
you'll understand when you watch it.
No, I completely understand. And speaking of what the future holds, that's pretty much the end of the episode. We got to the fourth season, which is something I'm looking forward to.
Watch more, damn it, Miguel. Watch more. I could do this every week of the day.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And you know, when we bring back the series in whatever form we bring it in, as I'll make sure one of the first episodes we do start talking a bit more of Doctor Who. Hopefully by the time this gets brought back, I'll be done with the fourth season and I'll be into Matt Smith's season.
How easy is it for you to watch every weekly episode of Doctor Who?
I have Hulu, so I can literally binge watch the episodes if I want to.
Can you watch the latest episode, like, you know, couple
yeah,
of days?
Yeah, I think when a new episode comes out, it's uploaded to Hulu. So I think I got the most recent episode on Hulu.
Well, then I suggest that we do a series of podcasts called the Doctor Who Roundup.
I'll think about that. But yeah, like I said, folks, this is going to be the last episode, at least as far as on the Retro Unlim network. Hopefully when Burhan is able to get his stuff together and we can get a network up and running, we'll have more episodes coming up. You know, I thought I'd make it to January, but I think at this point the show has gone as far as
it's a good run.
It's been a good run.
And I would like to say very much thank you, because what have I been on here for, 18 months? I'd like to say thank you very much for asking me to be part of this, you know, podcast. I really appreciate it.
It's been fun. I really have. And, you know, it kind of feels like an end of an era, because it was Maya's show, it was IGG, it was XFI Live, and it was the Unradio show that were the first four episodes on this network. And I'm like, I'm the last official original episode to come in, because IGG was a carryover from the other network we were on. XFI is no longer around as far as the show. Unradio show, I don't know what Travis is doing. And there's been countless one-off shows that people have been trying to do on and off. And I can honestly say this.
The only, the only pre-existing shows left are Slabcast and
Yeah, I mean, it's I got it as far as I could, but you know, hopefully when I do bring the show back in whatever incarnation, even if it's just a general talk show.
Dude, not hopefully. Please bring it back.
Yeah, well, as far as the Untitled Movie Show, I don't know if I'm going to keep the name because I don't know how much name the name value has, but if I do bring a show back, we'll see what it's called. I may bring back the Untitled Movie Show. I'd have to think about it, but as far as this era, I'm going to close the book on it and see where it goes from here, but let's not doom and gloom. Let's go out with a bang. Let's go out with plugs. Burhan, you're here. You haven't done one of these in a while. Plug your shit.
Please.
I've got nothing for you guys. MichaelBurhan.com, www.michaelburhan.com. You want to see show reels, you want to see bits and pieces, go on there. Also, there's going to be a huge revamp coming Halloween for Enigma Entertainment. The website's going to be up. There is going to be a brand new revamp from the studio. We're going to be starting to sell merchandise, DVDs, and also T-shirts. If you're up for any of this stuff, guys, I would advise you to go to there. We're also planning a big short that's going to be coming out for Cannes as well, plus a pilot for our Silent Hill pilot. I will, and I'm going to be saying this, and I know a lot of people are going to be down on this, be putting a donation button on the Enigma Entertainment website. Reason being is if you want to contribute and help us out in terms of like either purchasing stuff from us or also helping us with a one-off donation, you can do that. It all helps towards making our stretch goal of getting this pilot done.
Even if it's not Silent Hill, I still want to at least get something out because dealing with Konami at this point is kind of a crapshoot given their business.
Well, that's the thing as well, and I'm not going to say too much about it in terms of investors. I've got a few people I've been talking to about actually looking at buying the license. I've even talked to one of my contacts in Konami recently about how much it would cost. The money, it doesn't. The goal seems the amount they want and that they would sell it for could be obtainable. But there's also a few other rumors and stuff going around about them and their licenses. So I will let you. I won't say too much about that. All I'll say is there is a lot coming. I'm also looking at other ways to kind of do things at the moment. I'm currently, if you guys don't know, I've been homeless for the last 5 going on 6 months. I talked about it at the beginning of the show. So I'm currently kind of trying to concentrate on that, get things sorted out, and then move forward with myself and my lovely lady, trying to figure out what I'm going to do next, what my goals are. The idea is to kind of move to LA and then try and get things up, as I said, working actor. So that's what I want to do, get the production company up and running and start focusing about cultivating our own kind of mark in the film industry and leaving something that I can leave behind to, like, you know, my children and their children's children, so to speak. Maybe even be the next Disney. You never know. People used to say that Walt Disney was mad for his ideas and his plans.
Does that mean we have to cut your head off and freeze it?
Maybe so, yeah, Dave.
It might help.
As long as nobody, like, you know, uses me as a masturbatory tool, okay? Just saying. But yeah, that's pretty much it, guys. I'll probably return to do an odd show here and there whenever I get the chance. I'm currently, like,
we really, really appreciate you coming back, by the way, Mike.
Hey,
really,
dude, I missed you guys. You know, at the end of the day, it's been a while. I've missed a lot of you guys. And I've, the thing is, most people, I've tried to kind of capture the situation in terms of homelessness in my YouTube channel. If you go to youtube.com/TheNerdGenius, and I talk about various topics to kind of keep myself sane. But unless you've lived on the street or you've lived in my situation, you won't know how severe the homelessness situation is. The amount of times I've broken up fights with people trying to kill, like, freaking homeless people. And I mean, actually go out and try and kill these guys. Guys that I've given money to, well, not really money to, but more food and shelter and tried to help out because I felt, you know, there was a lot of guys worse off than I was. And I've just been trying to do as much positive as I can do. And I've been coming on, like, having a look at some of these shows, trying to figure out how we're going to retool it. And there is going to be some good news coming out of the network soon. But I just need to get everything else rolling first, all the plans rolling beforehand so that I can start moving forward with the idea. Because nothing lasts forever,
just
guys.
Just make sure you stay safe, Mike. Just make sure you stay safe.
Oh, I have been, dude. Don't worry, I'm good. I can take care of myself. The only thing I can't defend myself against for some reason is the fucking flu. But apart from that, everything else has been going well. I've been having, you know.
Stick around after the podcast. I got a fucking great food
share. Well, I mean, we can't have the reason I'm ending it as briefly as I have is because I don't want Burhan to stay on too long. He sounds like he's dying. So
yeah, I basically just want to let you guys know, you know, have a good one. I love you all, and hopefully we shall see you again at some point. I will hopefully be back to retake the reins of I Got Gameplay, depending on if the show will ever exist again in this current incarnation, if anyone even gives a shit. And, you know, that we're going to try and do something to kind of bring back what we've worked for, because, you know, I spent the last 2 years building fucking all these shows and look at it. But yeah, so thanks very much, guys. I will bid you guys adieu. Have a lovely one. See you, senor. Goodbye.
Peace.
And Vita Zane. Peace out.
That was our fearless leader, ladies and gentlemen. Dave, where can we find you?
You can find me at Lawn Boys Post 1975. If you like retro video games, vlogs, waffles, topics, things to discuss, then you can find me there. And also, if I can ask a personal favor for everyone out there, I don't want to do it for views, but I just feel it's an important topic to discuss. I turned 40 today, so I put a video up.
Dude, you
about
can pass
talking...
for 30.
Thank you, sir.
You look fucking younger than me, you cunt.
Yeah, the check's in the mail, mate. Both of you. How much do I owe again? I put a video up talking about, do you ever wake up one day and it turns out that you're a 40-year-old who plays video games? And the whole point about it was, you know, right, maybe I'm old. I am old. But especially going to a funeral today, that made me feel really old and made me realize that, you know, mortality is a thing that we should not take for granted. But the video I put up, which is, and you know, I hate long videos. I really hate long videos because my internet's shit. But my video is bordering on 20 minutes and it's me talking about why being 40 is a big deal because, and I stand by this, it meant I got to live through the greatest development of gaming history ever. You know, I'm talking Pong, Atari 2600, Spectrum, Commodore, Amstrad, Master System, NES, SNES, Mega Drive, you know, up to
just think about that, folks. Me and Dave have actually lived through all these consoles.
Yeah, and the point of the video was, and I'm sure I'll get a load of hate on it, but the point in the video was, do you know what, right? I may be old. Would I change it? No, I wouldn't, because, you know, lots of people these days, young, I can't believe I'm going to say this, young whippersnappers talk about, oh, we got PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One. You have no idea how great we got.
Dude, don't even get me started on these fucking news of today, mate. God.
I would like to say maybe I'm 40. Maybe that's bad. But all I know is I wouldn't change my gaming history in a second because I think
Dave, you're
I
like
got
a
to
fine wine, you've matured.
Yeah. I think I got to live for the greatest evolution of gaming ever. I got to live from Pong to the current generation. How many
and
people
think about
get
it this
to
way? You know, Bedrooms to Billiards, we live that. We live that.
I mentioned that. So yeah, you know what? Maybe I'm old. Who gives a fuck? Because the bottom line is this. There are people out there who like retro and they would kill to grow through and experience the shit that I've experienced with gaming. It wasn't retro for me when it started. It is now. It wasn't then. And it was a fucking fantastic journey and I love it.
And that's one to grow on, folks. So yeah, Lawn Boys Post 1975 on YouTube. Give Dave a couple likes or subscriptions on YouTube as a birthday present. That'd be a nice birthday present. You don't have to pay anything.
I'll just send him some free shit, you know.
Send him an Xbox One, please.
Yeah. Oh, that's coming, Nick. That's coming. And you and me are gonna throw down when it does.
Oh god.
And speaking of Nick did us a favor. He's recording the episode.
Yeah.
We'll be putting
Thank
this up
this so
week.
This.
Yeah, I'll get it up here in the next couple days before Slamcast for sure. I've been delaying me watching.
You sound like a porn star without a fluffer.
Oh, God.
Oh yeah, because we're waiting to see our special person, aren't we, Nick?
Oh, yeah, just, oh, LOL, TNA. Anyway,
I'm going to mark fuck it out.
Yeah. Thank you. Mark all it right. out, bro. Insert
go ahead,
fucking...
Dave. Plug your show. Oh, no, Nick. Plug
wow.
Sorry, excuse me.
Anyway, I'm over on YouTube at the Game Picks is 187. Me and Dave did a side-scroller Sunday where we basically made the NRA enemies list.
Yeah,
it's a pretty long list.
They'll never fucking slap us on the back again.
Oh, fuck you, NRA. Anyway, I'm over on Twitter at Game and Pegasus 187. I'm on Facebook at Nick Horacek. I'm in the Wrestling / MMA Revolution Facebook group. I don't know why I don't fuck it up outside of Slam. I don't fuck it up outside of Slamcast. But anyway, I post Slamcast there, which I'm on every Friday night. Usually me, Dave, and Brandon. And whenever Dave can make it, if he's not sick or whatever the fuck. But yeah, Hell in a Cell this weekend. It's going to be good. I'm all over the place. Miguel?
And you can find us, you won't be finding us here, but you can find our back catalog on youtube.com/unlim. Is it Unlim Radio? I haven't done this in about a month, so I'm a little bit rusty. youtube.com/unlim radio, I believe is the, let me actually type that in. I do apologize for that.
youtube.com/unlim radio, facebook.com/unlim radio. Yes. Go to any of the sites, check them out, and click and clack on that like button. Subscribe, yes, ladies and gentlemen, if you can as well. And
Twitter.com/unmovieshow is the official Twitter. From there, you'll be able to find the official YouTube channel for the Untitled Movie Show. Haven't put up any episodes in a while. I've just been backlogged. I ran out of space on my computer, and I'm still trying to get up enough money for a hard drive. But I just had to spend $5,000 to pay off some loans, so it'll be a while going. But hopefully, by the end of the year, I'll have a good enough computer to where I can start recording on my own. Hopefully, with the setup that we have with the new network, that'll be a good thing. But yeah, check us out in the future, guys. Hopefully, we'll have something up and running. So for the last time, for myself, for Michael Burhan, for Dave Wade, and for Lone Boys Post, well, for... Fuck it. Take us out, Jay. Nick Hart.
Celebrity voices are impersonated. No celebrities were harmed in the filming of this episode.
Excuse me, sir. The show's over.
Get away, zit face.